How rare perfection, the endeavor which goes exactly as you'd like it. As pages are added in the coming years to the book on the history of Lehigh football, the one on the 1998 team will always, always draw closer scrutiny. With one more giant step over an arch nemesis both dangerous and hungry to end a three-year winless streak in this historic series, Kevin Higgins' Legions could for all times be known as among the very best ever at the university. As the years go by and the legend of it all shrouds the details, those lucky enough to have been part of it will hold on to the precious moments, the singular plays, the exact circumstances.
We were down 14-7 at
fourth down situation.
Then the defense went on the field.
The offensive line started controlling the line.
Defensively, we were able to shut down their offense a lot better than we had ever expected.
The call is met right at the line.
A huge play in that game was a personal foul against Sam Brindley when they didn't retaliate back.
When the offensive line started getting a push on them, you know, Ron got a couple runs around the end.
Obviously the kick, it seemed like the ball hung up there forever.
Perfection, not one single blemish, not since 1950 at Lehigh. On the other side, a Bill Russo team, if not perfect, typically hard-nosed, growing stronger at the stretch run, capable of ball control with stalwart Leonard Moore. Standing ready, defiantly. If perfection's the prize for Lehigh, Lafayette stands guard over the diamond case, and they'll be in no mood to easily allow their fiercest rival to walk through the door and slip away with a precious stone. And in a way, it is a nugget, so rare and perfect that people will fight for it. Consider, too, that even if there were not a rare prize in question here, these two would always contest with great ardor and valor the other commodity which to them is worth fighting for every third Saturday of every November for well over a century, 134 times. Bragging rights between these two great schools. Lafayette, Lehigh, next.
Channel 69 Sports presents the 134th meeting of Lafayette and Lehigh.
Live from Fisher Field on the campus of Lafayette College in Easton, Pennsylvania, this is the 134th meeting in college football's most played rivalry, Lehigh at Lafayette. Hi again and welcome, Rich Lerner, and a cast of thousands. Kim McQuilkin to my right, John Leone to my left, Eric Marsh, Jeff Fisher will be along as well as sideline reporters. It's a cold and windy day here in Easton. Kim McQuilkin has already asked me if he could borrow my overcoat, and the answer, frankly, is no. We're looking for a great football game today. John Leone, we mentioned at the top that Lehigh has a chance to do something very special, complete an unbeaten regular season. Lafayette, on the other hand, has an opportunity to do something that they will remember for the rest of their lives, and that is spoil that perfect season.
Absolutely right, Rich. This is a game that makes memories, and over the course of so many years, so much has been written about this game. But I came across something yesterday that I think has special significance for number 134. Whoever said that one game cannot tarnish a football season never lost one of these games. For Lafayette to have any degree of success at all, Rich, I think the recipe is a three-part series. First of all, they've got to come out of that locker room with a lot of emotion. The second part is not so easy. They've got to transform that emotion into focused, fundamentally sound football. The third part is the most difficult of all. They've got to sustain that focus and that fundamental play over the course of a 60-minute football game. If they can pull that off, this one, Rich, could be one for the ages.
Absolutely. It won't be easy because the Lehigh team they will face is arguably one of the greats of all time. It's a team that is hitting, Kim McQuilkin, on all cylinders right now.
Well, it really is, and what an addition. Defensive coordinator Joe Bottolieri has been to Kevin Higgins' staff. The defense has really turned it around this year, and given the offense time to gel early in the season, this Lehigh offense is a juggernaut, Rich. I mean, over 530 yards the last three games. Phil Stambaugh completing 67% of his passes. That's an all-time Lehigh record. Well-balanced and explosive, a tough team to stop.
Should be interesting. Can Lafayette pull one of the great upsets in the history of this series? Will Lehigh finish its regular season unbeaten? The questions will be answered. We will have the kickoff in one of the great games in all of college football straight ahead.
Mountain Dew, a smooth, one-of-a-kind blend of citrus flavors. Mountain Dew quenches your thirst like no other. One taste and you'll agree, it's Dew-rific.
Drink Mountain Dew and you'll discover what's inside quenches like no other. A blend of citrus just for you, so smooth it goes down easy too.
Neato!
That's a classic.
Tradition, honor, a legacy, reputation, a leader. To some, they are just words, but to Brown Dobb, they signify everything we are. Brown Dobb is a proud sponsor of the Lafayette Leopard Athletic Program.
Perfect for any game, Domino's has the perfect play. Choose from three delicious crusts. There's classic hand toss, crunchy thin crust, or go deep with thick ultimate deep dish. So make the call and have it all.
For hot and wild, call Domino's. Now!
Call now and you can enjoy a delicious Domino's pizza during the game. And why not add some of Domino's spicy buffalo wings or steaming hot breadsticks?
After my accident, I was on several painkillers. I considered surgery, but I was scared. I didn't know where to turn. My friend told me about Ziegler Chiropractic. The doctors there are experts in whiplash and spinal trauma. They correct the cause of the pain and don't just treat the symptoms. They gave me just the right, gentle, effective care I needed. Now my pain is gone and I feel great. And best of all, they filed all my insurance paperwork. Now I know there are options thanks to Ziegler Chiropractic.
Ziegler Chiropractic, always on call, always there for you.
Welcome back to Fisher Field. Rich Lerner, Kim McQuilk, and John Leon with Eric Marsh and Jeff Fisher down on the field. This is meeting 134. They first played this game back in 1884. There's head coach Bill Russo. Yale and Princeton fall second on this list, and this is Rivalry Saturday. Yale and Harvard, a great football game, and Lehigh defeated Harvard at historic Harvard Stadium earlier this year. Texas with Heisman hopeful Ricky Williams, and Texas A&M, another great game. Stanford and Cal, and then always a sensational meeting between Army and Navy. Michigan and Ohio State get together today in a big Big Ten matchup. Lafayette leads this series all time, 71-56-5. Lehigh has had the better of it of late. This senior class has not lost a game to Lafayette, and don't think for a minute that doesn't weigh heavily on the minds of seniors on the Lafayette side, guys like John Green. Their last win came back in 1994 here at Lafayette. Let's go down to the sidelines to Jeff Fisher.
A lot of the credit to this defensive come up this year goes to Joe Bottolari, who's really turned it around. This is not a big defense. I talked to Joe before the game. He said this truly is a team. Everybody flies to the football, and people are there to help out. It's done it all year long, and the pressure will again be on the defense today because Lafayette has such a big line up front. They're going to have to shut him down and not get worn down. That's what Lafayette wants to do. I talked to Kevin Higgins before the game. He said the key to this game is the first 6 minutes to get the nerves out, get it underway. Just before he brought the team out, he gathered them all around and said, guys, this is a 60-minute football game. Don't forget about it. Let's go back upstairs.
All right, Jeff, you saw Lafayette and Maroon. Are they ever fired up? Lehigh a little bit more businesslike. Let's go down and get some thoughts from one of the great players in this series, Eric Marsh.
Thanks, Rich. Well, the word in the Lafayette camp all week long has been more. Leonard Moore, that is. Leonard has quietly become the second leading rusher in the school's history, and he's only 15 yards shy of his first 1,000-yard season. But amazingly enough, he's never walked off this field after a Lehigh Lafayette game a winner. On a different note, the Lafayette coaching staff really believes this team could have been 6-4 with some better luck early on in the season. But they did put a total game together last week against Colgate, and they built some confidence. They're hoping to take that confidence into this game and shock the college football world. Back up to you, Rich.
Thanks very much, E-Train. Temperature at 44 degrees, but with the winds gusting at points at 31 miles per hour, it's a little bit colder, and boys, it feels up here. And the forecast, no rain, and we should have a pretty good day for football. Let's get some quick thoughts here before the kickoff from our team up here. Kim McQuilkin, what do you look for in the early going?
Well, I think the biggest challenge facing Lehigh is whether they're going to come out tight or not. If they come out, you know they're not going to be overconfident because it is Lehigh Lafayette, so they're going to be up for the game. But they've got a lot riding on this, an undefeated season, national ranking, and soon to be announced a 1AA playoff appearance. So their challenge in the locker room, Kevin Higgins' challenge coming out onto the field, was keeping the team loose, keeping them normal. And I think we ought to look early for whether they are tight, a drop ball, a fumble, a missed tackle. Let's see how they come out and perform early.
John Leone?
Well, Rich, on the Lafayette side of the ball, we talked a lot about their emotion coming into the game and the great opportunity that this game presents them. But you know, Rich, emotion cannot block and tackle. I think Lafayette has got to transform that emotion into fundamental football. If they can do that, again, we ought to be in for an interesting afternoon.
Once again, Lehigh unbeaten. They last did that in 1950. Lafayette 3-7, though very easily they could be 6-4 were it not for some heartbreaking losses earlier in the year. We are underway, and Lafayette will take the kickoff, and it's Lanier, and he is dropped.
Rico Gladden on a great hit on the kickoff, Rich.
Well, the Lafayette quarterback is Mike Palos. He's a big fella out of Bethlehem Catholic, and the numbers are hardly staggering. You see only 4 touchdowns, 4 interceptions. Did have a pretty good game a week ago for the first time this season. They got things on track. They will need to elevate that passing game if they hope to have any success. And the give on the first play is to the big fullback, and that is Tommy Williams. Good backfield. Williams is a real horse, and Leonard Moore closing in, as we heard, on that 1,000-yard mark. If he can stay healthy, and he's had a knack for getting dinged up in some games, if he can stay healthy the full ball game, they could have a shot. Barrett Hammonds is a good wide receiver. Big House Rouse, 300-pounder up front, leading that offensive line, and there is Leonard Moore, a local product from Phillipsburg, and that'll bring up third down. Martucci is just a great one. Pettit and Slayton don't get enough credit for clogging the run, but they've done a good job. And Wolovich has come on at the other end position. Very speedy linebacking core. All 3 of these guys can run and get after the football. They're led by Ian Eason. Sam Brindley is the stalwart in that secondary. It's a pretty good one. Overall, a solid defense. Third down play coming up. Leonard Moore has got the first down for Lafayette on a 3rd-and-2 carry.
John, some thoughts on Leonard Moore. Well, Rich, I have to tell you early on here, obviously Leonard is the anchor of this Lafayette College running game. You see the statistics right there. He's quietly amassed nearly 1,000 yards. Expects to go over that today. This is a big game for him because, as Eric alluded to, he's never walked out of this game a winner.
Williams, the ball carrier, as Lafayette on its first several plays has gone to the ground, and they are moving the pile. Tom Williams. And this is the kind of ball control that Lafayette will have to display this afternoon. I think one of the goals, Kim, is to shorten the game, shorten the clock.
Well, you're absolutely right. The running games of these two schools are very similar. They're both averaging 170, 180 yards a game. The key to Lehigh's 4-3 defense is the strong safety, number 31, Brimley. Watch him try to get up inside the box to participate in stopping the run game.
First down again for Lafayette. It's Leonard Moore, and this time he is brought down in a good play inside by the big fella that is Pettit. Kevin Higgins told me that Pettit and Slayton really have gone unnoticed this year, but have done such a good job in the middle. You're, at first glance, you want to throw all of the kudos, and much of it is deserved, to Nick Martucci, such an outstanding player. But don't forget about those two guys in the middle. Second down, 11, a yard loss on that play. Just underway, Lafayette with the first possession. They're trying to grind it out. Moore sneaks ahead for maybe a yard, yard and a half on that play. Not much doing in on the stop for Lehigh is Brian Wolovich. Wolovich, a good story, really. Did not figure into the Lehigh defensive plans at the start of the season, but due to some injuries, he has been forced into action. He's played some great football the last couple of weeks.
Yeah, this is a real key play coming up here. Third and nine. Situation Lafayette really doesn't want to be in. They'd like to get more on first and second down. Let's see how they deal with third and long.
Halos to throw for the first time this afternoon, incomplete, and so that Lafayette drive, which began with a bit of promise, stalls. Joe Luke, the intended receiver, and Joe has had some problems hanging on to the football the last few weeks.
Right, Rich. You know, Lafayette's passing woes have really been a shared responsibility here. At times, the protection breaks down. At times, there have been drops. At times, Michael hasn't been as accurate as the coaching staff would like him to be, but not a bad drive. You know, the Lafayette defense has been overworked. I think field position is going to play a part in this game, and a rather effective drive that time for Lafayette despite being stalled right here.
Adam Holt on to kick it away for the Leopards, and this one gets hung up in the wind, and not a very good kick. And Lehigh will begin with fairly good field position. Ball at around the 37-yard line. Phil Stambaugh, Kim, has had just a sensational year.
Well, I think the most spectacular statistic as we look at them there is that 67.4%. I mean, imagine going a whole season. That's not a game stat. That's the season stat, completing almost 70% of their passes. And what a tribute, really, to the whole offense and the coaching staff.
Stambaugh the pitch to Ron Jean, and Jean's got the corner and he's tripped up, but a good opening play for speedy Ron Jean, who's also extremely strong. Brian Baker fighting an injury. Brett Snyder, the fullback, whom Kevin Higgins calls the best blocker he's had here in a long, long time. John Stiegler up front with Bodner and Sullivan. It's a good offensive line. This offense has been a machine in the last 4 weeks, outscoring opponents over the last month or so by an average of 40-10. Here's a short pass, and it's complete to Brett Snyder.
You talk about unsung heroes, Rich. Brett Snyder, the fullback, number 39, out of the backfield that time. This is a workhorse fullback, usually used as a blocker, but he's got great hands, and it adds another dimension to the Lehigh offense that big number 39 can come out of the backfield and make the kind of one-hand catches you just saw there on the sidelines.
Third down, short yardage, 1 yard to go for the first down. Lehigh with a ball at its own 47-yard line. We're just underway, meeting 134 at Fisher Field. Lehigh in white, and the give is to Gene. He's got the first down and a little bit more, driving forward. Ron Gene showing you some of that power that he possesses. He's only 5'6", about 182 pounds, but he can bench press 410 pounds. This is the defense he'll run against. John Green is an outstanding player, preseason at All-Patriot League Defensive Player of the Year. Ryan Hiles a bit dinged up, but a good run stuff for Tuma. And Ibekwe solid in that defensive backfield. Pass over the middle is incomplete. It was intended for Cody Fedorcha, and it'll bring up second down 10. 10:05 to play. That's Angel Colon, and there's Phil Stambaugh.
And almost a big play by Angel Colon. Lehigh trying to mix it up that time after the first down, came out with the quick huddle offense. Got right up on the ball, called the play from the line of scrimmage. Here you see Stambaugh in the pocket. He's got all day, but surprisingly, thrown over the middle, he hits the wrong color jersey there, Rich. Big break for Lehigh. That wasn't a turnover.
Stambaugh to throw on second down, and this one is poorly thrown, incomplete intended for Brett Snyder. And Bill Russo talked yesterday that Lafayette will need to create a turnover. John, that's an area they've been very good in this year.
Yes, as a matter of fact, their giveaway-takeaway ratio is outstanding among the leaders in the nation. Rich, what we're seeing right here is something the coaches alluded to yesterday. They don't believe that they can bring effective pressure on Phil Stambaugh. He just gets rid of the ball too quickly. He's got great vision. They're playing maximum coverage, and right now Lafayette is providing great coverage in the secondary.
Third down and 10 out of the shotgun. Stambaugh over the middle. It is complete, but it will be short of a first down. And on the reception for Lehigh is R.J. Ryan, the big tight end.
Kevin Higgins has the first decision, really, in this ball game. It's fourth down. You would think they're clearly in four down territory. Fourth and two from the Lafayette 38. Right now, it looks like they're sending the punt team out and playing that field position that John alluded to earlier.
exactly right. And I do believe that in a game, especially early on, Kim, I do believe field position is going to be a big factor. If they can pin Lafayette deep here, they could gain significant yardage on the exchange of kick.
Well, if you're Lafayette, you're really heads up for a fake right now. They may be trying to draw them off sides. They may try a number of things here at 4th-and-2 deep in Lafayette territory. And now we're seeing a switch of personnel on the Leopard side. They're probably bringing in a prevent kind of defense, expecting some kind of funny business here, Rich.
Well, Jay Heibel is the Lehigh punter, and having a good punter is often overlooked. When you talk about good football teams, Lehigh won the Patriot League championships in 93 and 95 with Craig Melagrano getting almost 43 yards a kick, Talbot 95 better than 38, and Heibel, a freshman, averaging almost 41 yards per kick this year. Solid kicking game for Lehigh pretty much all the way around. This one is delivered, not exactly what he wanted, hoping to get it inside the 10. Instead, Lafayette will have it first down at their own 20-yard line. We have no score. We're just underway. Meeting 134. Lehigh and Lafayette will be right back.
Hello, my name is Dr. Emil DiOrio.
The Computer Center is a proud sponsor of Lehigh football.
If the ocean were a couple of blocks from your house, you'd be there every day, right? Now imagine the next best thing, the Shore Thing, Marblehead Grill and Chowder House, where we bring the ocean's best right to your mouth. Live lobster and fresh seafood in a variety of tasty combinations. And for those who don't like to surf, there's great prime rib and steak. Either way, you'll be filled to the gills with great food. For something casual, coastal, cozy, and close, go with the Shore Thing. Marblehead Grill and Chowder House, William Penn Highway, a mile and a quarter west of Easton's 25th Street.
Well, a good old-fashioned bonfire got things stoked this week over at the Lehigh University. It's not a rivalry unless you have a bonfire somewhere along the line, don't you think?
Are they burning books? Is that what they're doing?
Come on.
Oh, sorry.
Use a little bit of that warmth up here right now. It kind of looks inviting.
Kevin Higgins talked the other day about trying to generate the enthusiasm among the students, and hard not to when you're 10-0. On the other side, Bill Russo and his staff have had a tough go this year, but Coach Russo on the brink of a monumental victory, number 100 here at Lafayette College. Bill Russo has been a real credit to this institution.
Wonderful guy, a class act.
There's Tommy Williams with good yardage, finally dragged down by Brendan Moore and Sam Brindley. So first down call. Tom Williams has been an integral part of this offense, John.
Rich, one of the most complete games offensively that Lafayette has played this year came against Holy Cross. And not coincidentally, it was the same game that Tom Williams returned from an injury. He gives their offensive running attack a lot of diversity. He's a great blocker and a power runner between the tackles.
4.5 yards per pop out of Central Catholic. Leonard Moore, over 1,000 yards for the season with that run, which gives Lafayette a first down. So Lafayette having success running the football. The product of Phillipsburg, New Jersey, the 95 Patriot League Rookie of the Year, has hit a milestone mark.
Yeah, one of the keys is the fullback Tom Williams at the point of attack. You see Leonard Moore bouncing it outside. You know, Tom Williams comes from an excellent football family. In Allentown, Froggy Williams, his uncle, I played against from Allentown Central Catholic. The Williams brothers, Tom and Froggy, tough guys, tough guys.
Kimmy gives this this offense a huge emotional lift as well as a physical lift. And interestingly, he's a power runner, but watch his feet, Kim. You'll appreciate this. He's got great feet. He gives you a little hip and he takes it away, and he's as agile as he is powerful.
Well, Eric Marsh was saying how he's a lot faster than people really give him credit for, considering his size.
I walked past him yesterday, and I swear he was a defensive tackle. That's a big boy.
Well, Lafayette came up just a hair short of that first down, so it's second down and about a half a yard, and they inch forward to get that to first down. And again, this is all playing into Lafayette's hands. Grind the clock, shorten the game, keep that high-powered Lehigh offense off the field. So Leonard Moore, for the first time in his outstanding career, goes over 1,000 yards for a season. He's the second leading all-time rusher here at Lafayette, and be a long time before anybody catches Eric Marsh. There's Tom Williams, and you can see what a rugged back he is. Squares the shoulders and goes forward for a good game.
A powerful runner, Rich, and a key first down play. Rich, what Lafayette has to do is stay out of the second and third and long situations. Their passing game just isn't consistent enough. If they can consistently get into third and short, second and short, their offense is going to be in good shape.
7:20 to play in the first quarter, no score. Second down, 5 for Lafayette, primarily behind Leonard Moore, this fella, and Tom Williams, his partner. Fumble on the play, and Lehigh's got it. Lehigh has got it, and they are going to go in for a score. It's Trey Slayton. They're not going to get there, but Trey Slayton with the big play, and just what Lafayette could not afford to happen. Grinding the clock, they put it on the turf. And that one hurts. Trey Slayton picks up the fumble, returns it, and there is a Lafayette player down on the field at about the 40-yard line.
Rich, we talked earlier a lot about field position, but in a game this big, with this much emotion riding on the game, we really neglected to talk about the turnovers, and anytime you're playing a game like this, turnovers are key. You got to avoid them.
Another look at it. Leonard Moore out of the eye. Again, he's bouncing it outside. Lafayette's been effective taking it outside the tackle, but look at that tackle. Helmet right on the football. Let's take another look. Let's see who that was.
Well, that's a great play right there by Kevin Joseph.
Kevin Joseph, number 9, the cornerback, coming up and really putting a lick on him. That's Alabama style when you put your face mask right on the football.
Big fella ran out of gas a little bit. Trey Slayton, 6'2", 220-pounder from Austell, Georgia, an engineering major. It's a play he'll remember for a long, long time.
You know, really a tough break for the Leopards because they're moving the ball well on the ground, moving it on first and second down on this drive really well. And what a big break to turn the ball over at that critical stage.
Well, it's a huge plus for Lehigh and an absolutely devastating offensive series for Lafayette. But, you know, Kim and Rich, all season long, the defense has been called upon to answer these kinds of calls. They're backed up now. They're going to have to do it again.
Well, big number 55, Jim Goff, one of the offensive linemen, the left tackle, a 275-pound senior, fortunately is okay. He walks off the field. The Lehigh defense comes up with that big play, and they've got great field position.
Lehigh is going with the no-huddle offense. They do this frequently after turnovers and big plays. They're going to come out and try to take advantage of Lafayette backpedaling.
Ron Jean, as Lehigh begins from the Lafayette 17-yard line. And
mentioning that Lafayette defense, they play a 50 defense. That's 3 down linemen, 4 linebackers, an odd front defense. And you see Ron Jean last week, and boy, he had a big breakaway touchdown for over 70 yards as part of those 193 yards. But second down for Lehigh, Rich.
He got 3 on that first down play with Tuma making the tackle. Here's Jean again, and he's trying to bounce it outside, and he hurtles forward, and that's a pretty good play by the defensive back, Angel Colon, who's very solid.
An absolute staple in this Lafayette defense. And Lehigh's in a situation right now. We talked about a contained defense, but I have to, right here, the speed of Jean gets the corner, and Angel Colon comes up. His experience, his recognition, right here, it looks like Gene's going to get something. There's Angel Colon, a great run support right there. Look for a blitz here. It could be a situation, 3rd, 4, and 5.
From the shotgun, Stamba under pressure, and he goes down. It's Brian Tuma.
Yeah, it was an outside blitz, and I'll tell you, Rich, I talked to the coaches yesterday. What they said was they could not consistently blitz Phil Stamba. He reads too well. They've got 5 in the pattern. But in a 3rd and 4, 3rd and 5, they will blitz in certain situations.
What Lehigh's trying to do here is screen to the wideout underneath. Stamba fakes left. They're trying to set up a screen to the wide receiver outside coming in. Just too many Leopard jerseys there, and Lehigh's going for the field goal now, Rich.
Field goal try is good. It is absolutely perfect. Jaron Tafe hits the field goal for Lehigh, and they have the early lead. It is 3-0, capitalizing on that Leonard Moore fumble. We'll be back with more first quarter action in just a moment.
For true comfort, it's the Comfort Suites Hotel in Bethlehem.
Located in downtown Bethlehem, just a few blocks away from the beautiful Lehigh University campus, the Bethlehem Comfort Suites offers a variety of rooms and suites to suit your needs. Our friendly staff works hard to make your stay a pleasant one. Try our full-service restaurant, a great place to meet after the game, the Bethlehem Comfort Suites. When you're visiting Lehigh, stay with us. The Comfort Suites Hotel in Bethlehem is a proud sponsor of Lehigh football.
This is Jim Henderson and his buddy Mark Larson, the best of friends, inseparable since they were kids. Yeah. They do everything together. This year, they took up skiing and bought almost identical equipment. Mark got his equipment at a fancy ski shop. Jim, however, came to play it against sports, where he traded in some used sports equipment to get the lowest possible price on skis. It also meant Jim had money left over for lessons.
Play it again sports, next to Kmart on MacArthur Road in Whitehall.
Lehigh football has a proud history and a winning tradition. A tradition that's built on ambitious goals, a sound game plan, and teamwork. At First Union, we use the same approach to enrich and simplify your life. We offer the widest variety of financial products and solutions. Services range from traditional checking and savings products to investments and trust planning. Call us and let us introduce you to our team, and together, we'll build a winning tradition.
My success as a small business owner didn't happen overnight. A lot of energy and a lot of persistence got me here. But it's time to take the next step. I need to grab people's attention and make a lasting impression. I need to be sure they'll know to call on me.
Get the Target Select advantage. We're today's business advantage. Tomorrow's business success.
You're watching WFMZ, Channel 69.
It's all about tradition and sometimes controversy. Controversy over star halfback George Barkley canceled the meeting in 1896. Seems Lehigh had discovered Barkley played semi-pro baseball during the offseason. That disqualified him from collegiate sports. And here's the return for Lafayette, and not much doing there, but Elijah Beeman gets it out to the 32-yard line with Lehigh leading at 3-0. Just back on that historical footnote, coincidentally, Barkley had ripped the Lehigh defense for 8 touchdowns in the school's 2 previous meetings, and the Maroon in 1896 finished the season unbeaten and earned a share of the national title with Princeton. How about that? Well, Lafayette maybe dodged a bullet. First down here, giving up only a field goal after the fumble, and Palos with a rare throw, and it's complete. Out of the backfield to Tommy Williams, who is a busy guy today. Bounced out of bounds by Sam Brindley, so Williams getting an awful lot of work.
And there he shows you his versatility. He's got good hands, he's got good agility, and they can use him as a receiver out of the backfield as well as a blocker and a power runner.
But this is exactly how the Lafayette offense should function. They were pounding away on first down, getting 4 and 5 yards in that last drive. Bingo, you come out on first down with play action pass.
Second down and 2, and Tom Williams slips up on the turf and maybe got a yard on the play. They trail it 3-0. Jaron Tate, who's had a very good season, kicked a 37-yard field goal. He is now 9 of 14 on the year and a perfect 3 of 3 from between 30 and 39 yards. Hasn't missed an extra point. 40 of 40 this year. So it tells you, we mentioned Heibel, Lehigh's kicking game has been very sound, and on the other side, Lafayette has struggled. Third down and 1. And the give is to Leonard Moore, and this time he hangs on, and he has more than enough for a first down. In on the stop for the brown and white is Matt Andrews.
Lafayette going with a full house backfield here. 2 tight ends just stacking it up. Nothing fancy here. Just hard-nosed football over the left side.
Ryan Mayo delivered a very solid block to spring that hole. He's a backup running back. Very tough kid. This is Ryan Mayo, and he tucks it away the way you're told to do, and he's got some good yardage.
And pretty interesting, Rich, on first down that time, Lafayette kept their short yardage team in the ball game, went again with 2 tight ends, a full house backfield, and they are playing smash mouth football right now. They're just teeing it up, running right at them, man on man blocking.
you're Bill Russo, John, you've got to be happy.
Absolutely. That was their Tiger set. It's a double tight end, and one thing you can do to counter the great speed of a Lehigh defense is go right at them, and Lafayette's doing that effectively right now.
Lafayette's offensive line quite a bit bigger than that Lehigh defensive front, which relies on speed, and on that play, not much there. Nick Martucci in on the stop.
Martucci really played that well. Again, the full house backfield. This time they're trying to run the option as we look at the young man starting his 44th consecutive game for Lehigh. That time played the option extremely well, forcing Lafayette now into a third and long, about a third and five, and a pretty tough call for Lafayette. You can tell there's some confusion in the huddle, and quarterback Palos wants a timeout. He's going to go over and talk to Coach Russo about it.
Right, Kim, and this is a situation that Lafayette has wanted to avoid all year long, and especially in this game. Anytime they get into a third and four, third and six, the passing game just has not shown the consistency needed. But again, I think that this is not a situation where a team wants to be using their timeouts.
Well, what they're talking about right here is, are we in three down territory or four down territory? They're on the Lehigh 44-yard line. They could conceivably go for it on fourth down, so it affects the play calling. They could stay on the ground for two plays. And there we see some students, obviously in graduate school. They could stay on the ground, or they could go play action here, Rich, on third and five.
Those guys are just returning from the bonfire, obviously. They need some cool down.
Trey Slayton, the man who recovered that fumble, which set up the first Lehigh score, the only score. Looking on, the Leopard Band in full regalia here on a great day for football. A little cold, but has not dampened in any way the great enthusiasm always on display. Third down and five for the Maroon. Nick Martucci in the defense trying to put a stop here. Palos from the shotgun. He'll roll, and he's capable of running with a football. Nobody's open, or are they? It's caught, and that is a first down. Barrett Hammonds on the reception.
I'll tell you, a real nice job by Barrett Hammonds. Initially, this play is covered. You're going to see Palos out of the shotgun. He's going to roll to his right. Leonard Moore is the lead back. This is a design roll. But watch the receivers stay active. And Hammonds actually curled up inside and then worked his way out to the sideline. Good job of working yourself open. Then you see him turning upfield. Now he's just going to shake it outside. Brimley on pretty good coverage that time, but Palos bought some time, bought his team a first down.
Good patience that play on the part of Mike Palos.
Leonard Moore off the left side, and good room for Leonard Moore. And it's Nick Martucci once again in on the tackle, but Lafayette moving the football once again.
A great first down play for Lafayette once again, second and short. In this situation, the Lafayette playing, as Kim alluded to, smash mouth football, running real effectively between the tackles.
Well, Lehigh sits in a 4-3 defense. That's four down linemen, three linebackers. And so far, that guy right there, 31, Sam Brimley, has not come up hard and run support. And that's why Lafayette's moving the football.
Second down and three, and the pass is incomplete.
Kim, this play call right here might go back to your previous point about four down territory. It's second down, but Lafayette's offensive thinking could be that they've got three more cracks at it, so they try to throw a pass on second down.
Well, I think absolutely down here inside the 35, they are in four down territory. It was only second and four. You'd actually consider that a rundown. They're trying to cross up the Lehigh secondary with a pass that time. Let's see what they do here, third and four, Rich. Out of the shotgun.
Palos nowhere to go, and he's brought down for a loss. It's Brian Wolovich in there, along with David Pettit.
Well, I'll tell you what Palos saw right here. He's out of the shotgun. He's looking at pass. He sees Lehigh in a man-to-man defense in the secondary. When you see man-to-man down inside the 30-yard line, a lot of times it's a great time for the quarterback to pack it in and run, because if you get by that initial line of scrimmage, you've got nobody between you and the goal line. That time, though, the defense shut him down, didn't allow him out of the pocket.
Loss of 6 yards on that play. It'll bring up fourth down and nine.
The loss took him out of four-down territory. Fourth and nine, you can't go for it.
Adam Holt kicks it away. And Lafayette playing the field position game.
Lehigh's going to make him do this one over again, Rich. I don't think that Lafayette, it was an illegal procedure call. They were late getting a substitute into the game.
Boy, and I'll tell you, if that's true, another break for Lehigh. Another break for Lehigh if this is a penalty. There you see it, John. Good call. Movement in the backfield. Let's see if we can see it at the bottom of the screen. Yep. Part of the punt team not out on the field, and boy, it was a great punt executed, the pooch kick inside the 20. Imagine starting on your own 5-yard line. I'll tell you, Bill Russo's got to be happy. 35 seconds left in the first quarter. He's down 3-0, and he's got great field position. A critical mistake. Let's see if Lafayette can come back and duplicate the punt inside the 20.
It's going to be a situation, too, Kim, where the statistics are not going to tell the story the score is not going to tell the story.
Well, Lehigh came after Adam Holt that time and didn't get him, and that penalty did mean something, because Lehigh, instead of beginning at its own 6, will begin at the 16-yard line.
Rico Gladden got a piece of that football on the punt that time, guys. Very close to becoming blocked, and even though they touched the kicker, the official allowed it because he actually gets his hand on this ball. Right here, the left hand of Rico Gladden glances off that ball. You'll see the official give the indication that he touched it. That's why, even though they hit the kicker, no penalty.
So in the final seconds of the first quarter, Lehigh will take over with a 3-0 lead. Stanball with all day to throw it deep down the field, and wide open is Deron Braswell. And a big play. Lanier made the tackle, but not before Braswell came up with a huge gainer.
Now watch what Lehigh's going to do after a big play, the hurry-up offense. They don't want Lafayette to regroup. Stambaugh's in the pocket. Lafayette's playing a double zone, two deep. There you see the two safeties. The way to beat it two deep is throw your slot man down the middle. That's where Braswell went.
53-yard pickup, and now it's Brett Snyder on the little dump, and he's got good yardage, very close to another Lehigh first down.
And clearly, Rich, right here, Lafayette back on their heels, and Lehigh smelling the blood a little bit and going for the jugular. I thought that play action back here on that big play really froze those linebackers and created that seam that Kim talked about.
Kevin Higgins and Phil Stambaugh have really pushed all the right buttons this year. Stambaugh has obviously come into his own.
And, you know, actually, Kevin Higgins taking over the coaching of the quarterbacks this year. As we see the measurement, Lehigh's going to be just a little short. Kevin Higgins working closely every day with Phil Stambaugh, and I can tell you, you really see a difference in the maturity of Phil Stambaugh's reads and his audibles at the line of scrimmage. He's really grown up this year.
I've seen him a couple of times, Kim and Rich, and I'm just impressed by his poise in the pocket, and I know that that's a direct result of Kevin's influence on him, but I'm just so impressed by his kind of his stature back in the pocket. He reads things real well. They've got five guys in the pattern consistently, and his release is so quick. It's very difficult to blitz him.
You see the turn of the quarter, Rich. It looks like Kevin Higgins is really trying to get a specific play from the press box reading the Lafayette defense.
The end of a good first quarter. It is Lehigh 3 and Lafayette nothing, but as we come back for the second quarter, Lehigh will be knocking on the doorstep looking for more.
There's a reason Overhead Door of Allentown is called the original. That's because we're the leader in the industry. Our superior construction, innovative technology, and professional sales and service set us apart. Our customers ask that they can have beauty and still have security. Once an overhead door, the answer is yes. Now that's original. The genuine, the original Overhead Door of Allentown. Look for us in the Yellow Pages under Doors.
Hello, my name is Dr. Emil DiOrio. I'm an orthopedic surgeon and one of more than 75 medical providers at Coordinated Health Systems. Every day, we provide medical care to hundreds of people who have been hurt at work, home, or sport, and help them return to a healthy and active lifestyle.
Stop by or call one of our locations today. Coordinated Health Systems, the team that makes you feel better.
Because life has its moments, there is KWM for personal insurance. An independent agency offering a full range of personal protection and coverage choices.
as your family grows.
Your grandson, Dad.
Kressler, Wolf, and Miller. Proudly protecting the families of the Lehigh Valley for over 75 years.
Unless you win the lottery or inherit a small fortune, let's face it, you're working. But while you're out there jumping through hoops, Edwards Business Machines is jumping with you. One of the top 10 Konica dealerships in the country, Edwards gets you through the day with the right products and the best service. So next time you're thinking, take this job in, shove that thought aside and call Edwards. They work harder to make your job easier. Edwards Business Machines, your authorized Konica copy or fax dealer.
Interesting numbers as we look at the first quarter stats, Kim.
Well, you know, we've been saying it all first quarter, but Bill Russo's just got to be loving those 76 yards on the ground for Lafayette. That's really kept them in the football game here, and that's even with a turnover.
In the time of possession, heavily in favor of Lafayette, but Lehigh with their quick strike offense in position to get a little bit more. Ron Jean, the ball carrier, and ball is loose. Looks like Lehigh has recovered.
That fumble cost them the first down. I think that Ron Jean had the first down, but when the ball hit the ground, I think he lost 2 yards on it. More of a power set that time, Kim. Didn't you see that? I thought that they brought the tight end in and ran it up the middle.
Phil Anderson on the recovery for Lehigh.
You can see the tight splits of the Lehigh offensive line, and nothing fancy. That's just straight ahead man-on-man block. It looked like pretty good initial thrust, but not enough for the first down. And now a third and short, Rich.
Give us to Ron Jean, and Jean has the first down for Lehigh.
You know, Ron Jean's got over 800 yards this year, filling in for Brian Baker. Baker out now with an injury, and Ron Jean with the real low center of gravity kind of combines a Mr. Inside, Mr. Outside technique. You look at what he's done so far this year, averaging 5 yards a carry with 11 touchdowns, and really in part-time duty.
Brian Baker with an injury to the foot tendon, so he will not play today. And Lafayette reads that play perfectly.
Rich, that was
Brian Tuma.
That was Brian Tuma, Rich. And he has been, along with Angel Colon, really the backbone of this secondary for Lafayette. He's quick. He's experienced. He's a senior. And covered that effective screen.
Well, I think this is good scouting by Lafayette, too. Brian Tuma is a strong safety. He's really coming up strong from the strong safety position. Lehigh known for a lot of quick screens, and that time Tuma all over it.
Well, the receiver, Rick Moore, never had a chance there. And Stambaugh will dump. It looked like he was going to run, and it's Ron Jean. And Gene is down to the 6-yard line. So Phil Stambaugh made something happen on that play.
Well, this is another example of Stambaugh's maturity. He's back in the pocket. He's got trouble. He knows to step up, but he also knows where his second and third release valves are. And this time, here you're going to see him in the pocket. He's going to step up. That's what you're supposed to do. You're taught to come up through the middle. And he says, hey, wait a second. I'm not paid to run this thing. I'm paid to flip it. He finds a guy who's paid to run it, and run he does.
I was in a meeting yesterday, and there was some talk about Brian Baker probably not being ready to play today. Given the fact that they had to face Ron Jean, the Lafayette coaching staff wasn't really overwhelmed with that information.
First and goal now. Lehigh leading it 3-0. Ron Jean down to about the 3-yard line. In on the tackle for Lafayette, Chad Williamson, along with Angel Colon.
Throughout the course of the year, fellas, we've heard opponents talk about Lafayette's physical play, and right here they're going to have to dig in if they can somehow keep him out of the end zone. Again, a big moral victory.
Second and goal, Gene. And oh, he does not get in for a minute. He looked like he was going to have little problem in crossing the goal line, but then Williamson came up and made a brilliant stick on that play.
This is great second effort by Chad Williamson, the junior nose tackle. He's actually blocked initially at the line of scrimmage, but then he fights off the block and comes back and makes the tackle on the 1-yard line.
Third and goal from the one. We're the brown and white. Gene doesn't have it. And so that'll bring up a fourth down and goal.
But what a great job by the free safety that time.
They got really low on the play. I mean, the center of gravity, the free safety came up. I think it was Cologne, but he absolutely funneled under everybody and just took out the interference.
Coach McQuilkin, what are you doing?
You see him just selling out in the backfield, throwing bodies around.
Tremendous play.
Take another look at it. Watch from your left side.
John Fitzner
coming in. What a great effort. Fourth and one, Rich.
Hand off Bron Jean. He's got the corner and he's got the touchdown.
So after a valiant goal line defensive bid by the Leopards on fourth and goal from the one, Jean, instead of going inside, heads outside and has little problem scoring. It is now 9-0 in favor of Lehigh.
An example of the great speed of this Lehigh football team. Knocks on the door, and I'll tell you what, Ron Jean showed what he's made of right there. Great speed.
That's Ron Jean's 11th rushing touchdown of the season. Jaron Tate is again perfect on the point after. 41 of 41 of the season, and early second quarter, Lehigh leads Lafayette 10-0.
Your best choice for cardiac care is right here in your backyard and has been for 125 years at St. Luke's Hospital. Last year, more than 750 patients chose St. Luke's for their open heart procedures. Our cardiac program performed more cardiac surgeries than many metropolitan centers in Pennsylvania. And we achieved quality ratings equal to hospital programs in major centers in Pittsburgh and Philadelphia. Cardiac care at St. Luke's, another reason why we're your best choice.
On the gridirons, the diamonds for working out or lounging around. Suit up with the best, Russell Athletic. Available at the newly expanded Bethlehem Sporting Goods. Bethlehem Sporting Goods, a Russell Athletic team specialist, carries a large selection of Russell Athletic uniforms, tees, shorts, and sweats. And Bethlehem Sporting Goods offers custom lettering, screening, and embroidering of group and team Russell Athletic wear. Stop in today for Russell Athletic wear and all your sporting needs at Bethlehem Sporting Goods, the team sport and trophy specialist.
Construction has been underway to complete the Alfred P. Kirby Sports Center for its opening in 1999. The 110,000 square foot complex will give students a wide array of athletic and recreational options. And when completed, the center will include 3 basketball courts, a running track, squash and racquetball courts, a fitness room, locker rooms, and office space for administrators and sports medicine. Should provide the student body a wide array of athletic and recreational options, as well as enhancing community spirit. So much positive development in terms of the infrastructure here at Lafayette College and as well at Lehigh University. 2 great institutions, and there you see it is under construction, and that is where it will go.
Well, for personal and professional reasons, Rich, I hope they get it done, because I live across the street. I got to tell you something. There is a significant community component to that building, and it's just going to really take Lafayette's intramural and recreation program to another level. An absolute state-of-the-art facility.
And the Kirby family has always been so generous and so passionate in its commitment to Lafayette Athletics.
Rich, probably an example of generosity unequaled on any college campus anywhere in the country. And their generosity doesn't stop at the base of College Hill.
And it goes back to the turn of this century. They used to have parties for the football team up here at an old house on the hill. So it's a great legacy. And this is a very important possession coming up for the Leopards of Lafayette. They're going to start with good field position off that low kick. They've got it out to about the 35-yard line, but they're down 10-0, and they've got to make something happen here, Kim.
Yeah, it's a critical drive right now. You know, they've really been effective. You're looking at the Lehigh scoring drive, 10 plays, 84 yards, nice blend of run and pass. Of course, the big play being the play-action pass on first down. Here's the toss sweep, but look at 39, Brent Snyder, the fullback. He's the guy. He buries John Fitzner that time, the outside linebacker, and Gene was able to waltz into the end zone.
Lafayette sticking with its game plan, running straight ahead on first down. It's Tom Williams, but no gain on the play. Ian Eason made the tackle.
The problem for Lafayette right now, Rich, is that momentum is wearing a white shirt on that football field, and Lafayette needs to turn things around. It would have been a huge emotional lift had they been able to keep them out of the end zone. It didn't happen. The offense has to respond.
Stanball again with a great deal of efficiency in those numbers. And Palos has only thrown it four times. But Lafayette has run the ball fairly well. Second down, and Palos will throw this time. And the pass is caught by Joe Luke in a nice effort. That time, the Phillipsburg product went up and got his hands around the football. And Lafayette...
That's a big first down for Lafayette coming out here in this drive after the touchdown. And Palos that time rolling out to his left, got his shoulders square, put the ball right on the money. Nice possession type pass. The receiver knew where he was and got enough for the first down. So exactly what Coach Russo needed coming out of the shoot here after that Lehigh touchdown.
Ball at their own 47. Lafayette on first down. Palos throws incomplete, intended for Tom Williams. Second down, 10 coming up. Lafayette coming off a loss a week ago at Colgate against a very good Raider club, 42-27. Lafayette battled back in that game. They were down 21-0, but were within striking distance heading to the fourth quarter and just couldn't complete the job.
Right, Rich. And, you know, Kim alluded to something on the previous play. It kind of makes me feel good because he almost took the words out of my mouth. When Mike Palos completed that pass, his mechanics were very sound. There was a microcosm of Lafayette's passing game this season. Two plays ago, perfectly executed. That last play, fundamentally not so well.
Palos, and he gets rid of it just in time to Leonard Moore, but Moore doesn't have a whole lot of running room. A whole lot of white jerseys surrounding Leonard Moore, and among the defenders in on the play is Mike Emery. And Leonard Moore comes up hobbling on that play. And we mentioned earlier that he's been dinged up in and out of games before.
Seeing it from the end zone camera here, and one of the things that's really clicked this year for Lehigh are its linebackers. That time we saw Ian Easton, number 41, putting pressure on the quarterback. And then the outside linebacker, Brian Appling, filling in on the pitch man. Good mobility. There's Brian Appling coming in and getting a piece of Leonard Moore. But good mobility by the linebackers this year.
Well, that's Phil Yarborough.
And again, Palos rolling to his left. It seems he almost throws better to his left. You know, sometimes right-handed quarterbacks will be more effective to their left because you overemphasize getting your shoulder square. When you see perfect execution that time, a lot of times rolling to your right, you kind of take it for granted. And you won't be as effective, but rolling to the left sometimes, right-handed quarterbacks are more effective. That time, Palos was.
And he got the first down with the reception to Yarborough. And this is McCoy on the carry, replacing Leonard Moore and doing a good job at that. Finally corralled, but not before picking up another Lafayette first down.
Hey, Rich, if we get another look at this thing, watch number 55 just clear the way. That's Jim Goff, and he was down a few plays earlier, but right there just escorted that running play around the right side.
That's Eric McDay on the ball carry here. He's from Oil City, PA, a junior.
Well, this is kind of, both teams run this play. It's kind of the old Washington Redskins counter tray, pulling the off tackle. And that time, Lafayette very effective at it, coming back out with play-action pass, Rich. That time to Williams.
A great drive.
We said early on that this was going to be a big, big point in this football game. Could Lafayette respond to the Lehigh touchdown? So far, so good if you're a Leopard fan.
Well, it's short possession-type passes. If you can get 4 or 5 yards on first down, then in second and short, this is a run-pass situation. It's second and four right now. If you're on defense, what do you call? Do you play run or do you play pass? Inside your 20, Lehigh's got to be very careful down here.
Second down and 3. Palos and a bad pitch, and Lafayette recovers.
And if, Kim, if we get another look at this, I believe that that play was there. But for the bad pitch, Lafayette might have been in business.
Well, I'll tell you, the outside linebacker, James Young, number 16, is really going to come up and stick the quarterback. That's good outside linebacking play, putting his helmet almost right on the football. Let's take another look at it. This is perfect play. You see the pitch man's covered. Brimley's out there, number 31. Good linebacker play from inside out by Lehigh that time. And this is where Lafayette doesn't want to be now, third and long.
Third down conversions. Lafayette has been successful.
Got the corner of the end zone.
Palos throws incomplete. No flags on the play.
Pretty good coverage that time by 31, Sam Brimley. I actually thought that Lafayette had a shot at the corner of the end zone that time. You see, Palos this time rolling to his right actually was not on the money, underthrew the football.
Intended for Joe Luke.
Kim, I thought he had a player underneath. It was an interesting decision on the part of Mike to go for the end zone. It could have been two down territory. They had about 8 or 9 yards to get. I thought he might have opted for the underneath man and gone with four downs.
Well, that's one of those great calls from the booth, John. You didn't have the linebacker in your face.
It's fourth down and seven, nearly intercepted by Matt Andrews. And so Lehigh will take over Lafayette without really any confidence in its kicking game, which has struggled all year, elected to go for it, and they come up a little short with the play by Matt Andrews.
Well, and there you see Lafayette that time out of the traditional drop back passing formation, and it's not what they do best. They're better rolling, they're better play action. The third and long, fourth and long situation forced them into that, and Lehigh taking over on downs.
So a good drive fizzles for Lafayette, and now the defense is charged with a mission of shutting down a Lehigh offense, which really has been clicking of late. Ron Jean, first down carry, gets a few yards.
And though Lafayette failed on that possession to put any points on the board, in some respects it was successful. It's been the pattern this year that the defense has been overworked. They were able to garner a few first downs and thereby giving the defense some time to rest.
They have outscored their opponents in a huge way in the last three games, just playing with so much confidence right now offensively. Stand ball. And Rick Moore doesn't generate a whole lot. That's the second time they've gone to that play, and for the second time, it hasn't really worked.
Yeah, and a great play that time by the defense. Lafayette that time was in a two-deep zone. Was that Jamie Wislowski?
Sure was.
He was the cornerback. He rolls up on that play, taking the short zone, and he did it perfectly. He was actually blocked, came off the block, and good defense. And now Lehigh's got a third and long.
Third down and eight to go for the first down. Stambo with time guns it over the middle, and it's dropped. Uncharacteristically, that's Joe Falzone, the intended receiver. That.
I like the execution by Stambaugh, though. Lafayette playing a two-deep zone. The place you go with the football is down the middle against a two-deep zone. Falzone was the slot man that time. Stambaugh read it perfectly, put it on the money. Falzone uncharacteristically dropped the football.
There wouldn't be some ghosts flying around this place now, would there, guys?
Don't, let's not. All right.
Here's Jay Heibel to kick it away.
Low kick, returnable.
Yeah. It's Barrett Hammonds. Hammonds, and he'll give Lafayette very good field position in the Lehigh territory, down to the 44-yard line. And if that previous drive was important, this, too, is a very important drive for Lafayette, down 10-0 with 6:13 to go in the first half.
And these two drives are not unrelated, Rich. I believe that the effectiveness of that first drive resulted in the defense resting. They came out, made a good stand. On the exchange of kicks, Lafayette's back in business again.
Mike Palos, the quarterback for Lafayette, first down. And this is Leonard Moore. Moore off the left side has about 3-4 yards. Tough yards at that. Brian Wolovich in on the tackle for Lehigh. Leonard Moore, how is he feeling after getting banged up early on? Let's find out. Here's Eric Marsh.
Guys, Leonard Moore hurt his ankle that he hurt about 2 years ago. He injured it on an option play about two series ago. I talked with Matt Bailey, the trainer. He said he's okay. They're going to watch him from now on, but keep an eye on it, guys.
Well, Lehigh had its eye on Leonard Moore that time, and they dropped him for a loss. Again, Wolovich is in there. And Moore a little bit frustrated. That will bring up third down.
You know, really tough play call that time. Lafayette's been very effectively just going man-to-man, one-on-one blocking, good offensive thrust. This time more a delayed kind of play that allowed Lehigh's penetration. And I think on this play, Lafayette kind of got away from what's brought him here and going with the draw. Lehigh getting great penetration, and now all of a sudden Lafayette's got a third and 12, Rich.
Halos
down the middle.
Ample time, and it's incomplete. And there you see that passing game just isn't hitting the way it should. Phil Yarbrough, the intended receiver, and that will bring up a fourth down and 12 for Lafayette.
And for the passing game to be successful, and no one knows this better than Ken McQuilkin, but all three components have to be clicking. The pass protection, the delivery, and the reception. And one of those three components usually comes up to bite Lafayette.
Well, the other thing is, guys, this is fourth and 12. You know, not many teams convert fourth and 12s. That time trying to hit underneath the tight end, wasn't going to get the first down if he caught the ball there anyway. Bad kick. Man, I'll tell you, Rich, Coach Russo playing field position, defense playing tough, and you come up with a 15-yard, 17-yard kick. Man, that's a tough break for the Leopards.
Well, emotionally, it just wears on you because so many of the pieces are coming together, but that one hurt him.
Not the best effort from Adam Holt. We'll be back in a moment.
Tradition, honor, a legacy, reputation, a leader. To some, they are just words, but to Brown Dobb, they signify everything we are. Brown Dobb is a proud sponsor of the Lafayette Leopard Athletic Program.
Everyone's heading to the big game to support the team. There's only one problem. Everyone is sporting their Lehigh gear, and you're the odd person out. What are you going to do? No problem. The Lehigh University Bookstore is the answer to all your apparel needs. Whether you're a parent, child, student, or alumnus, you can show your school spirit by wearing a Lehigh sweatshirt, t-shirt, jacket, or even furnishings for your house. The Lehigh University Bookstore is located on the lower level of McGinnis Hall at the corner of Morton and Vine Streets. We're open Saturday, so you can stop in on your way to Goodman Campus.
Hello, my name is Dr. Emil DiOrio. I'm an orthopedic surgeon and one of more than 75 medical providers at Coordinated Health Systems. Every day, we provide medical care to hundreds of people who have been hurt at work, home, or sport, and help them return to a healthy and active lifestyle.
Stop by or call one of our locations today. Coordinated Health Systems, the team that makes you feel better.
Lehigh is joining some rather elite company. This marks the best regular season record in school history. The 1950 team coached by Bill Leckenby went 9-0. And the John Whitehead led the 1980 team finished its regular season at 9-0-2. Lehigh has won 11 straight games dating back to last year, and that equals the school record established by the 77-78 team. These teams also undefeated. Lehigh, one of six unbeaten teams in 1A or 1AA. Kansas State, a tough game with Missouri today. Tennessee against Tim Couch in Kentucky. And UCLA will have its hands full with USC. Georgia Southern, maybe, who knows? Lehigh will run into them down the road if everything goes well. Bill Stanball throwing on first down, and the pass is complete to Cody Fedorcha.
And Phil Stanball out of the shotgun that time. You'll see Stanball out of the shotgun a lot. He really likes the shotgun. He's comfortable with it. It gives him greater vision. And that time he rolled to his right, bought himself some time, and Fedorcha worked himself open. Good first down.
Local product, 6-footer, 184-pounder from Slatington. He's a business major. Cody Fedorcha, real star in the making. First down, 10, Ron Jean scoots around the left side, and he's got pretty good yardage. It will bring up second down. We've got 4 minutes, 10 seconds to go in the first half. It'll be second down and two. Lehigh into Lafayette territory. And they played a reasonably efficient football game. Nothing too electric, but this is the mark of a great football team. Take advantage of the opportunities. Don't turn it over. Kick the ball well. And that's what Lehigh has done all year long. Gene, with good room up the middle, has a first down for Lehigh.
Big block that time by number 77, Steve Ludwig, the right tackle. Ludwig, 6'6", 270 pounds, and Rich, he's a converted quarterback.
Amazing.
There you see number 77 on the far side of the huddle. Came into Lehigh as a freshman quarterback. Moved to tight end for 2 years. Now converted to an offensive lineman. Had a great season.
First down 10 for the Brown and White. And it's Cody Fedorcha. And Lafayette reads that play fairly well. Pfister came up to make the tackle. This is an important stop here for the Lafayette defense. This could be a backbreaking, demoralized score if Lehigh were to get on the board yet again, take it into halftime, maybe 17-0. That would be a difficult mountain for Lafayette to climb.
Double-edged sword here, Rich. Two problems, obviously, the threat of a Lehigh score. But the other thing is that this game seems to be turning, and the thing that Lafayette was doing so effectively earlier, Lehigh seems to be taking over the line of scrimmage. Not a good sign for the Leopard defense.
Second down, 8. It's a Lehigh team, which has gotten stronger as each and every game has gone along. Ron Jean wrapped up by Angel Colon and company.
And you gotta like Ron Jean. You know, we talked about his size, only about 175 pounds. I think he's 5'5", and he's got that low center of gravity. You know, one of the advantages is behind a big offensive line. There you see Ron Jean, the lone back. We'll look at it from the end zone. Defenses, it's hard to see him. Look at him duck down behind his tight end there. Sometimes you can't even get him in your vision if you're a linebacker on the other side of the football field, and he uses everything he's got very effectively.
Third down 3. For Lehigh, Gene and Ron Gene has got another Lehigh first down, or he should, very close to it.
And I'll tell you that time, Brett Snyder, the fullback, number 39 at the point of attack. He's the key guy in this Lehigh ground game, and that time just a knockout block on the outside linebacker. Let's see if we can pick up number 39, blocking on number 11, John Fitzner, the outside linebacker. That time, Brett Snyder, he's the guy that created the hole, got Lehigh the first down.
And that's well scouted, because all year long we've seen Fitzner blitz from the outside, and that time the fullback took it away from him.
Phil Stambaugh, not one of his better looking throws there.
Well, you know, he had a blitz that time. Lafayette came up, played some pressure, came with their linebackers, and I think Stambaugh read the blitz. Didn't hang on to the ball as long as maybe he might have, but you know, one of the jobs of a quarterback sometimes is just not to take a sack. And on first down, you know what, by the way, Rich, you know what sacks are on first down?
After working with you for 11 years, I
they're drive killers,
they're drive,
right?
Killers.
They're drive
killers.
Right,
they are. Second down and 10 with a buck 40 to go in the first half. Ron Jean looking for his blocks, and he does so effectively.
We talked about Steve Ludwig, number 77 that time. The big guy, the old quarterback, was out there in front of Gene, pulling from his right tackle position. See if you can pick up number 77, the big guy. You know, and sometimes good blocks come in different forms. This is not a knockout block. It's more like a screen block, but it's very effective. Does he kicks out that outside linebacker and opened it up for Gene.
8-yard gain, and now Gene burrows forward for yet another first down. Now, if you're Steve Ludwig and you come in as a quarterback and they tell you they want you to play offensive line, on the surface that may not seem like a great move. It's not as glamorous, but you say, hey, I get to eat whatever I want now. Right?
You know, and I know deep down in his heart, Steve still believes he's playing a skill position.
Redefining the position.
First down 10 on the 15-yard line. Stambaugh throws low, and it's incomplete. Intended for Bruce Peltzer, the junior English major from Philadelphia. Went to school in the Catholic League at Archbishop Ryan.
I'll tell you, Phil Stambaugh wants that football right now.
You got that right.
You know, he's going to look at this one on the films. He had 6. This was a great delay to the tight end. Here's Phil Stambaugh on the roll here. His tight end blocked down for a count and then just released out in the flat. He catches that ball, turns around. He's still running.
Yeah, he had the Lafayette defense completely sold out on the reverse. And boy, his tight end was all alone on that side of the field. You're right, Kim.
Phil Stambaugh, also a good baseball player for the Lehigh 9.
You see the graphic there, 48 seconds left in the half. That's why they're taking a timeout here. They really want to take their time on this call, guys. This is so critical. Just down 10-0. This is anybody's football game right now. Kevin Higgins wants 7 out of this possession. They're in the red zone. He wants the full 7. It's 2nd and 10.
Kim, I'm going to ask you this. You know, it's second down and long right here. We talked about Lafayette's hesitancy to blitz Phil Stambaugh, but in certain situations, they're going to do it. Now, right here, if you're the defensive coordinator at Lafayette, Paul Shaffner, you're wondering, do I come or do I sit back? Your call.
Well, one of the things that Lafayette's done all season, and they've done it very effectively, is they throw a variety of defenses at you. I was talking to the Lehigh coaches earlier this week, and you can't run a tendency on them and come up and say on second and long or third and short they're going to blitz. They come with a lot of different looks, and it's anybody's guess right now what they're going to do. To me, it looks like they're hanging back in a zone right here. That's what they're doing.
Next coverage.
Second down 10, and Gene very little doing. Good defensive effort. Williamson, again, who's played well here the first half for the Leopards. So 40 seconds to go. Third down, long yardage for Lehigh.
Take another look at it. Lafayette's got three men rushing the passer. That's it. They're double-teaming the two wideouts. Stambaugh trying to go to Ron Gene, and you can see Leopard jerseys all over him. Just excellent defense that time. The Leopard defense made the right call. They hung back inside the 20. You know, usually inside the 20, guys, you play man. Just because the coaches feel they got to put a body on a body that close to the goal line. But that time they went zone, and it really crossed up the Lehigh offense. We see again now, Rich, Kevin Higgins wants another timeout. 40 seconds left in the half. He wants seven here. He wants it bad.
Third down and 13 with 40 seconds to go. Lehigh struck first in this game after Lafayette had driven the ball down the field, ran the ball effectively, but Leonard Moore coughed it up. Trey Slayton returned it, and Lehigh kicked a field goal, a 37-yarder. Lehigh still with two timeouts left, and then Lehigh came back, and after a noble goal line stand by Lafayette, Lehigh was able to punch it in with Ron Gene scoring to make it 10-0. That's where we stand, and this is a critical play. Lafayette trying to hold firm here late in the first half and keep this game close. Stambaugh, third down, 13. Throwing for the end zone, and it is incomplete.
Wow.
And you don't see Deron Braswell drop balls that are that obviously catchable all that often.
Phil Stambaugh got exactly what he wanted. This time, John, Lafayette went with the opposite theory. They came up man-to-man, free safety in the middle. He's got Braswell man-to-man. That cornerback out there is on an island. Braswell beat him. Stambaugh put the ball on him. Braswell just couldn't hang on.
It's one of the reasons why, Kim, we talked about...
Take another look at it. I'm sorry, John. You see the free safety in the middle of the football field. He's free. He can go anywhere. Everybody else is man-to-man. Here's fourth down, Rich.
He's got it again.
Lehigh going for it, and they're going to go for the end zone, and it is... Is that a touchdown? No. Flag is down, though.
It's going to be a very interesting call.
Braswell
on the reception. Could go either way.
Could go offense, sure. He had the same exact thing, did he not, Kim? It looked like they blitzed again. The quarterback was ISO'd, and Phil Stambaugh picked it up.
Defensive interference. I'll tell you, you're going to see Braswell. There's a lot of incidental contact. You're right, John. It's man-to-man. Braswell loves working man-to-man. You see a push there.
I'd like to see that again. Not sure about that.
Let's take another look at it. This is actually after the foul. I think the push-off was about 2 or 3 yards before that. Right there, I think, is where the call came from.
The flag comes in, though, well after what we had thought was the infraction. And even at that point, not much of an infraction. It didn't appear to be.
Well, I'm not saying it was a great call.
Tough one on a game like this and a close one. That's
a tough blow for Lafayette.
With only 28 seconds left.
One more look. Here we go.
I don't think we're going to see the contact here. I think the contact has already occurred. That ball is caught out of the end zone. Clearly not a touchdown. He was not forced out of the back of the end zone.
Well, a big break for Lehigh. 28 seconds left. First and goal. Stambaugh.
What patience.
Incomplete and well defensed by Lafayette, and you've got to give Lafayette some credit. They are hanging tough against some difficult circumstances here.
I'll tell you, Phil Stambaugh really took a lick, and one of the things he does with this football, it's real tough to look right and then look left on a three-step drop, and the last thing you want to do on a three-step drop down over the middle is throw over the middle down deep in the end zone. So I think Lehigh dodged a bullet there, and Phil Stambaugh really took a lick, too.
Good play by Mike Levy, the outside linebacker for Lafayette.
That pass intended for big R.J. Ryan.
I'd go toss sweep.
It's a tight formation. They can do it from it. From this.
Stand by, incomplete.
Whoa!
Nearly intercepted.
Man, you get the feeling that this Leopard defense is just, you know, it's swarming just, to the football.
I tell you, Kim, it's almost a microcosm of what their season has been all about. I mean, inches. It's a game of inches. It has been all season long. You talked about Kevin Higgins wanting seven at the end of this first half. Conversely, if Lafayette holds them to three, this is still a two-score game, and Lafayette is very much in it.
Look at the maroon jerseys. They're swarming to the football.
Brett Snyder, the intended receiver, so some drama here as we play out the close of the first half. Lafayette desperately trying to contain Ron Jean, and he's in for a touchdown. So Ron Jean hurdles in off the right side, and Lafayette can hold up no longer. It is now 16-0. A very tough break for Lafayette on that interference call. And Lehigh capitalizes. And so Bill Russo clearly will have his work cut out for him in that locker room, trying to maintain the enthusiasm and keep his team spirits alive.
It's a good point, Rich, and it was the toss sweep that Kim alluded to. He was a play ahead of Kevin Higgins. But you're right. It's going to be a huge, huge challenge for the Leopards to come out and maintain that intensity. They've really played well. A couple of big plays have hurt them, a couple of bounces of the football, the poor kicking game. But you know what? There's a long way to go, and anything can still happen.
There you have it, 14 plays, 61 yards. And Ron Jean with his second touchdown of the game, his 12th rush touchdown of the year. The little fella has figured big into the Lehigh equation this year. Now, another look at the touchdown.
We were looking for the toss sweep earlier. The reason is that the Lafayette defense is known as strong and tough up front, but not necessarily mobile. And that time with a swarming defense, you got a lot of commitments early. And when they commit that early going to the outside, sometimes you can beat them around the corner. And you see the effort here. He leaves his feet about the 4-yard line and ends up 2 yards deep in the end zone.
And again, Brett Snyder cleared that hole with an excellent block. Just to underscore what we heard earlier in the game, Kevin Higgins told me that Brett Snyder is the best blocking fullback he has seen in the last 10 years at Lehigh.
Yeah, that's a great credit, and the great dimension that Snyder brings with the blocking ability is his ball catching ability. So you can send him into the line like he's blocking and send him on through into the flat, and he catches the ball well for you out in the flat.
Great compliment to that man, Ron Jean. Brett Snyder, an All-Stater in high school, local product. And Jean comes from Boca Raton, Florida.
And sporting the new Rich Lerner hairdo, I might add. Rich himself, Rich has a haircut.
Let's check out the latest in the Kim McCormick.
Don't even go there.
Hairstyle
Don't
fashions.
Even go there.
John Green, a bit of a character.
Yeah, John is, and he's every bit as tough as he is a character. And you know, the Lafayette plays that 3-4 defense, and in that 3-4 defense, the middle of it is so important. John Green anchors it.
My understanding is that he would paint it the different colors before every game. If they were playing Princeton, he would go orange and black on either side of the
Mohawk.
Was
that the reason for that? Because I've seen him in the lobby, and I'm thinking, gee, John, I thought it was a kind of a schizophrenic personality thing. But no, I guess it has to do with the opponent.
It's an intimidating look, isn't it? Lafayette with the football and 8 seconds to go, and at this point just don't want to make a mistake, and Palos is running for his life, and that is a dangerous play. He runs out of bounds, and that will do it. We have come to the end of the first half, and Lafayette certainly played hard, and they had things going the way they wanted them to go, ball control. But here we are against an outstanding football team, which really plays mistake-free, down 17-0 as they head to the locker rooms at the half.
Which, when you're playing a team like Lehigh, Lafayette's margin for error is so slim. And, you know, by the same token, Lehigh feels freer. They come out, they're diverse, they can do a lot of things, and they really pull out all the tricks today.
Well, stay with us. There's a whole lot more to come. We will return with the Domino's Pizza Halftime Report right after this.
there's a reason Overhead Door of Allentown is called the original. That's because we're the leader in the industry. Our superior construction, innovative technology, and professional sales and service set us apart. Our customers ask that they can have beauty and still have security. Once an overhead door, the answer is yes. Now that's original. The genuine, the original Overhead Door of Allentown. Look for us in the Yellow Pages under Doors.
Catch all the excitement, color, and fun with Pennsylvania's newest family attractions. At the Crayola Factory, the fun never ends. Right before your eyes, you'll see Crayola crayons and markers being made. And kids of all ages can play and experiment with dozens of exciting activities. And the Crayola store is a one-of-a-kind sensation, offering the most colorful and unique Crayola products and gifts. Both attractions are located on Center Square in Easton, just minutes from Route 22 and I-78.
After my accident, I was on several painkillers. I considered surgery, but I was scared. I didn't know where to turn. My friend told me about Ziegler Chiropractic. The doctors there are experts in whiplash and spinal trauma. They correct the cause of the pain and don't just treat the symptoms. They gave me just the right, gentle, effective care I needed. Now my pain is gone and I feel great. And best of all, they filed all my insurance paperwork. Now I know there are options thanks to Ziegler Chiropractic.
Ziegler Chiropractic, always on call, always there for you.
The evidence is based on careful research, with fastidious attention to minute details. The results of our study indicate that the region is best served with up-to-the-minute news, sports, and weather, weeknights at 6. Top news team Nancy Wertheim and Rob Vaughn bring you the most comprehensive coverage of the day's events.
Good evening, I'm Rob Vaughn. Tonight's top story.
Channel 69 News, serving you every night at 6.
Lunch.
Lehigh taught me values, both on and off a wrestling mat. And by learning those values, I learned to appreciate what is real in life and what's important. Lehigh kind of teaches you more than just a vocation. They teach you how to live a life.
On the other side.
Welcome back to Fisher Field at the half. Lehigh on top of Lafayette by a score of 17-0. And I'm joined at the half by Eric Marsh. And let's talk a little bit about the first half itself. Lehigh is obviously firing at all cylinders. Lafayette, though, has done some good things.
They have. They've moved the ball up and down the field, Jeff. The problem is they can't capitalize and put it in the end zone. Leonard Moore got off to a good start, but he turned his ankle. Once again, he hurt it about 2 years ago, and it's bothered him ever since.
One of the things we're going to keep our eye on here as we go through the halftime is how Phil Stambaugh is doing. He took a real big hit at the end of the first half, so we'll find out how he's doing. We'll have more during the halftime. Now let's check in on Joe Luke. Joe Luke, the senior wide receiver from Phillipsburg High School, playing football, going to school, and has an interesting job while he's here at Lafayette College.
Right now we're here in the auditorium of the Treasure Game Preserve, but usually you can find me out in the fields, actually working with the animals. There's no monotony to this job. There's only one thing that's constant, and that's just the feeding and the maintenance. But it ranges from vaccinations of the animals to behavioral observations to building new exhibits, providing new materials in exhibits. And it basically, it's a day-to-day job. It's each day we're encountered with different obstacles. I guess it started probably back when I was around 7 or 8 years old, just watching the Discovery Channel. I just fell in love with animals. And ever since then, biology has always been a field that has interested me, and it's been a field that I've always wanted to pursue. Lafayette has a great biology program. The best part about Lafayette is that it combines great academics as well as athletics. But probably the best part about Lafayette is definitely the professors there. One of my professors, Dr. Hill, Wendy Hill, basically set me up with this job here. I'm also doing research with her. And she's basically been a gift to me. She's done everything for me. She's gone out of her way. And I think a lot of professors at Lafayette do that. at a bigger university or a bigger college, some students might not have that opportunity to, you know, to get really, you know, to get one-on-one, to get close to a professor. Nobody really knew my specific interests at Lafayette. Obviously, animal behavior, zoology is not a field that you come across, you know, every day. But I mentioned it to a couple people, and eventually got to Dr. Hill. And she's, like I said, she's been great all 4 years that I've been here. She's provided so much to my experience at Lafayette, and I'm, you know, without her, I'm not sure what I would have done. I wouldn't be in this opportunity that I have right now. I wouldn't be in the place that I am right now. I'm on an alcohol congress, and basically what it is we try to provide other opportunities than just drinking. Some of the ideas we came up with was a shuttle bus from, you know, the campus down to the movie theaters, just more events, more comedians up on our own campus. And basically, like I said, it's just a way to get people to stop drinking and to let people know that there is other things out there to do. When I'm a Lafayette alum, I think the key point that has made me the person that I am is the interaction with the students as well as the interaction with the professors here. I said, the help that they've given me, you know, it can't be measured. And hopefully, you know, I'll be able to give back to Lafayette as much as they have given me.
Met Joe Luke several years ago when he was a senior at Phillipsburg. He, of course, was the teammate of Leonard Moore. They've come to college here together. A very, very quality individual, Joe Luke.
No doubt. There's two words to describe Joe Luke, and that's class act. He gets involved with the community, as you just saw. He's a local product out of Phillipsburg, and just a class act. Done tremendously well here at Lafayette. He does have an extra year next year, and I believe he is coming back to play one more year at Lafayette.
Good to see that, because Joe is a classy individual. We're on the Domino's Pizza halftime report. Going to go to a break and coming back with more. It's 17-0 at the half. You may remember that Lafayette was shutting out Lehigh last year. Don't go away. This game is far from being over. 17-0 at the half. We're coming back on the Domino's Pizza Halftime Report.
If the ocean were a couple of blocks from your house, you'd be there every day, right? Now imagine the next best thing, the Sure Thing, Marblehead Grill and Chowder House, where we bring the ocean's best right to your mouth. Live lobster and fresh seafood in a variety of tasty combinations. And for those who don't like to serve, there's great prime rib and steak. Either way, you'll be filled to the gills with great food. For something casual, coastal, cozy, and close, go with the Sure Thing. Marblehead Grill and Chowder House, William Penn Highway, a mile and a quarter west of Easton's 25th Street.
U.S. Airways, the Lehigh Valley's number one airline, is proud to be the official airline of Lehigh University Athletics. U.S. Airways operates more flights from Lehigh Valley International Airport than any other carrier and has served the community for over 30 years. Remember, Lehigh University Athletic fans, U.S. Airways begins with you.
Tradition, honor, a legacy, reputation, a leader. To some, they are just words, but to Brown Dobb, they signify everything we are. Brown Dobb is a proud sponsor of the Lafayette Leopard Athletic Program.
There's no topping for red robin. Come on along, let's all go bobbing to the red robin. Come on,
get hopping to the red robin.
You'll find something for everyone. Relax, unwind, we'll have some fun. Come on, let's go. There's no topping for red robin. Come on.
Tillman Square in Allentown and in Northampton Crossing at 33 North and Route 248.
I'm Barton Eckert of First Business. The world of business doesn't stop, and you can wake up to the world of business news and information on First Business. If it's happening in Washington, on Wall Street, on Main Street, around the world, or in cyberspace, you'll find it here on First Business. Watch First Business at 5:30 a.m.
Don't miss First Business, just ahead of Channel 69 News at sunrise. Weekday mornings at 5:30 here on Channel 69.
You're watching WFMZ, Channel 69.
welcome back to the Domino's Pizza Halftime Report. College football's most played rivalry, Lehigh and Lafayette at the half in game number 134. Lehigh leads it by a score of 17-0. Well, if you've been following Lehigh all year long, you've seen the development of the offensive line led by Jonathan Stiegler, a senior captain. When Jonathan was accepted to Lehigh to play football, something very interesting happened in his life. It changed his life. Let's have a look at that story.
This girl that I'd graduated high school with had invited me and a group of my friends to a graduation party. So we're there for a little while. I mean, everything seems like it's going fine. I look around and I don't see my friends around. And then one of them comes in from the outside and, you know, he says, you know, we gotta leave. We gotta get out of here. As we're walking out, people just start filing out of the house behind us. I start talking to this one kid who I'd met earlier that night, and I'm like, what's going on? Is there a problem, you know? And he says, oh, you know, I think your friends have problems, you know, I think you should get out of our neighborhood. And I'm walking away, and I'm walking to my car. And then I just remember I turned to two people, and they were kind of huddled together. And I didn't know what they were doing. I just remember hearing a shot. And then I'm clutching my arm. It burns a little bit, but then, like, it felt like an elephant was, like, sitting on my chest. So I knew it was more than just my arm. The bullet hit my arm, ricocheted off the bone, went through my chest, broke a rib and punctured a lung. It collapsed that lung. I was never really thinking that, like, oh, my God, I'm going to die right now. I think at that point, I was pretty changed as a person. For some reason, just at that point, like, I started having the attitude of, like, you know, we'll see what happens. I remember, you know, after all the emergency surgery and the doctor came in, and then I asked him if, you know, am I going to be able to play football again? He said, yeah, you are. You'll be able to play, but just not this year, you know. You know, he just said, it's up to you as to, you know, whether you're going to play again, as to how hard you're going to rehab and how bad you want to play. And when it happened, I didn't understand why. Like, everything seems to be going so well, and then that happened. And I questioned that for a long time as to why this had happened. And then, you know, my mother and my father would always say to me, everything happens for a reason. And at the time, it's not something you really want to hear. As time goes on, you just get to understand that, like, if A, B, and C doesn't happen, you know, D's probably wouldn't have happened to begin with. Like, if I never get shot, I wouldn't be here right now for my fifth year. You know, and I wouldn't be experiencing what's happening right now with football.
When John first called us about the incident that took place back at his hometown, I was shocked. I'd never dealt with a kid that had that type of situation before, but I knew a little bit about John and knew about his character and trusted that this was a good kid. And really, what our program is about giving guys chances. And that's what education is about. We're here to win football games and to bring a successful program, but the other part of it is watching kids succeed, and especially those kids that need a second chance, a second opportunity. If you can provide that for a young man, I think it goes a long, long way in life.
People are like, oh, you have the worst luck, you have the worst luck. But then again, you could look at it another perspective, which I try to do, and say I am pretty lucky because, yeah, these things have happened to me, but I'm still able to play, and I'm still able to do a lot of things that people with a lot of injuries shouldn't be able to do. My mother would always push that. You know, she would always have me try to look at it that way, you know. Like, you know, all right, these bad things that happen, but just look what you're able to do still. Look around you, look what you still have, you know. Just try to make it positive, you know. Try to, even though it's so negative, just try to make it as positive as you can.
Jonathan Stiegler, obviously a very special person, a lot of special people on this team, and maybe that's why it's been a special season so far as Lehigh tries to finish the regular season a perfect 11-0. They're halfway there at the half on the Domino's Pizza Halftime Report. Lehigh leads Lafayette 17-0. Coming back with more after these messages.
A watchful eye. Concern. Offering the perfect solution, synchronizing the entire team. Your Dick Milham sales professional. Watching out for your interests. Offering the perfect solution. Concern for your satisfaction. Synchronizing the entire team.
Join the winning team at Dick Milham Chrysler Plymouth.
Go Lehigh!
Dick Milham Chrysler Plymouth, proud sponsor of Lehigh football.
Isn't it amazing how fast kids outgrow their hockey equipment? At Play It Again Sports, we'll buy that old equipment and sell you something in a better size.
Late Again Sports, next to Kmart on MacArthur Road in Whitehall.
No matter what kind of used sports equipment you have, Play It Again Sports will pay you money for it. If your kids have grown or if you change sports, bring your old equipment in. We'll buy it and put it back in the game.
We have a service agreement with Fritz right from 1972. Well, anyway, there were real problems with that furnace. And through the service agreement, they essentially fixed everything so that it was like having a new furnace. When they came that time to fix all the problems that existed with that furnace, we never paid one single penny.
Fridge, for comfort you can count on. Because life has its moments, there is KWM for personal insurance. An independent agency offering a full range of personal protection and coverage choices as your family grows.
Your grandson, Dad.
Kressler, Wolf, and Miller, proudly protecting the families of the Lehigh Valley for over 75 years.
An individual that is doing research, it's an opportunity to constantly be learning something that's on the cutting edge.
It is pretty impressive. The Atlas Research Center or the electron microscopy facility or some of the equipment in environmental engineering and electrical engineering that are accessible to undergraduates through research projects are things that they probably won't find in their first job in industry because it is state of the art.
To the Domino's Pizza halftime report. 17-0, Lehigh leads Lafayette at the half. Eric, what does Lafayette have to do to put itself in a position to win this game?
Well, I think they have to stay the course, number one. They've got to stay with the run. They've got to evaluate the situation in halftime with Leonard Moore, possibly put Tommy Williams back at tailback. Remember, he had 128 yards against Fordham, and they won that ball game.
Injury update on Phil Stamble. He is okay. Took a ding to the chin and the back of the head. Hearing some bells, but he's fine. Jack Foley says he will start the second half. Let's go back upstairs to Rich, Kim, and John.
All right, thanks very much, Eric and Jeff. Nick Martucci in the defensive unit looking on. They put a donut on the board, and they have been extremely tough in the second half of most of the games this year. Now, first half highlights with Lehigh leading it 17-0.
Well, this, of course, is Leonard Moore, who's been a mainstay in the first half for Lafayette. This run right here puts Leonard over 1,000 yards for the season.
I think we're now going to see the 37-yard field goal, which was really the first score of the game. Lafayette defense tightened after the Lehigh drive.
Jaron Tafe has had a very good season. He kicks the field goal.
And now the two touchdowns, both of them on the ground. Both are toss sweeps to Ron Jean, the tailback, led by the fullback, of course, Brett Snyder, number 39. Again, Lehigh effectively getting outside inside the 10-yard line.
One of the distinctive differences between these two teams, I think, Kim, is this team speed. And right there, Ron Jean shows you why the Lafayette coaching staff was not real excited about Ron Jean even replacing as talented a runner as Brian Baker.
Here's the second touchdown by Ron Jean, and you see his athletic ability. And we mentioned he really got airborne around the 4-yard line on this touchdown. As you see all the enthusiasm in the end zone, that was a hard-fought touchdown. Real tough for Lehigh to get into the end zone that time, but again, they got it done going outside.
No, Rich, if you're a Lafayette Leopard fan, take heart, because if recent past history is any gauge, we got them right where we want them.
Well, comebacks are very common, especially in the last several years. Last year, Lehigh was down 21-0 at home. They cut the margin to 21-14 at the half, and they finally took the lead for good before winning the ball game. We'll get back to the comeback situation in a moment. Here are the halftime stats.
Yeah, pretty remarkable. If you look at time of possession, you look at first downs, and you look at total yards, you'd think the game was actually closer. Two big mistakes by Lafayette. One, the fumble in the first quarter on that great drive they were having going in. Lehigh, of course, taking possession and actually got 30 or 40 yards field position out of the fumble return. And then the second mistake, whether you call it a mistake, a good call, a bad call, was in the end zone. The penalty, the interference call, which gave Lehigh a first down on the 1-yard line.
One other item, too, Kim, is the lack of an effective kicking game has once again crept up. Key situations, a couple of shank punts could have turned things a little differently in that first half as well.
Brian Menicola to kick it away. It
not been a great season for Brian Menicola. Twice an All-Patriot League selection, and this really has been a very disappointing campaign as Lehigh returns the kick, and that is Rico Gladden, and it really was a result of the missed kick early in the season against Buffalo, and he was on the game cover that day, and there was a story inside detailing how he had dreamed of kicking a game-winning field goal. He got his shot from 31 yards, missed, and he's never been the same.
Rich, you know, and it wouldn't be so weird except for the fact that Brian's a senior, and he's been so consistent and so much a part of this this offense for 3 years, so it's a complete mystery.
Three games they lost because of the kicking game, right down to the wire, that could have them in a much different position and frame of mind today. On the first down run, it's Ron Jean. But they lost the game to Brown, they should have won, lost the game to Dartmouth, they really should have won in that game against Buffalo.
And all three were on essentially the, well, no, in fact, the last play of the game. And if they get two of those three, they're sitting here 6-4 today. So, Rich, it was an incredible turnaround. They really dug themselves an early hole that they have been struggling all year to get out of.
Psychologically, it was difficult to overcome because they were very painful losses. But as it stands, they've got to put it together here in the second half, down 17-0, just underway. Rich Schroeder, Kim McCook, and John Leon, and intended for Joe Falzone. Phil Stambaugh off the mark. It brings up third down.
Well, second and long that time. Lehigh came with four wide receivers, a one-back offense. Stambaugh tried to go out to the flat to the slot man. Just overthrew the ball. Now third and 10.
And I believe in no huddle, Kim.
Out of the shotgun.
Stambaugh guns it. Sideline. It's complete. And it's Deron Braswell. Braswell has the first down for Lehigh.
I'll tell you, Deron Braswell really put a move on the cornerback for Lafayette as we see him limping a bit back to the huddle, not taking himself out of the ball game though. But what a great move he put on a long curl pattern to the outside. Take another look at it. Out of the shotgun, we mentioned Stambaugh loves a shotgun, throwing the ball to his left. Deron Braswell really turned around the Lafayette defender, actually made him fall down.
You saw the left tackle guilty of a hold right there, I believe, Kim, and I was amazed at how much time Phil actually had. And that long curl took a long time to develop. And I think one of the reasons, obviously, was that hold in the part of the left defensive tackle, the left offensive tackle.
Here you see the time Stambaugh has. And look at the left, you see the left arm there, the, number 75, that's a hook that he's putting on him there. That's a WCW move.
Oh, baby.
Look at this.
And it is caught by Deron Braswell. Well, he was limping, and now he's making a great play.
Remember how Jimmy Brown, old enough to remember Jimmy Brown used to limp back to the huddle and slowly back to the huddle, put the defense to sleep. How does this happen, though? Third and 22, and you got to believe the Leopards are thinking, whatever we do, don't let them get beyond us in the secondary. Just a critical mistake that time by the Leopards secondary.
Got behind Jeremy Beeman, and Lehigh is back in business after being pinned near their own goal line. Give us to Ron Jean. Jean with a little bit of room. And if Lehigh were to score on this possession, that would make it very difficult on Lafayette.
You talk about character, though, Rich. Character of an offense, character of a quarterback. Third and 22, and we're looking again here at Ron Jean, but in a nice hole there by the offensive line. But third and 22. Back inside your own 5-yard line and you throw the ball downfield and get the first down. I mean, that's what undefeated seasons are all about.
On a rope. That ball had eyes.
Stambaugh. And that play was well defensed by Lafayette. Brian Endler, a reserve wide receiver. And Curcio made the play. So Lehigh, two or three times this game, has tried to throw that little flare pass and generate something, and it really hasn't worked.
Yeah, well, it is a screen behind the line of scrimmage. Actually, they did get the first down here. They just picked up a couple of yards, although it wasn't a very effective play. You know, John, right now, Lafayette needs something to happen. If I'm the defensive coordinator of Lafayette, I've got to try something. I've got to mix it up. I've got to stunt. I've got to do something that fools the offense, because I need a turnover right now.
And it's a strength of the Lafayette defense. They're among the top 10 in the country in takeaways, and right now is what they need. They need a takeaway.
First down play. Gene, not much there. Williamson closes the play. Ryan Hiles in on the stop as well.
Lehigh tried to double team big John Green, that time number 67, and he just burrowed into the double team and really closed up the hole. Nice job that time by the defensive tackle. There we see 67 Green.
And teams that have opted to block him one-on-one have paid dearly, and there you saw Lehigh do an effective job of doubling on him.
Second down 8, and they fake to Gene, and Stambaugh slings it over the middle, incomplete, intended for Braswell. Defense nicely by Angel Cologne.
Angel Cologne displaying something that we've grown accustomed to all year long, Kim. This is a great shot separating the receiver from the ball.
You know, Angel Cologne is only about 5'7", which is real short for a free. Usually free safeties come a little taller than that. But he's so active, and he's always around the football. And there you see he likes a little bit of contact, too.
Yeah, he's physical. He's physical, and he's aggressive, and he is built more like a cornerback, your conventional corner. But he's playing safety, and I'll tell you what, he can come up and put a lick.
Third down. And 8, Stambaugh, little dump to Gene, and a good job again. Williamson has been in on a number of plays. He's had a fine game for Lafayette. That'll bring up fourth down.
Lafayette has shown good diversity with their defense. It seems like every week there's been another player, whether it's Ryan Howes, Jamie Wozlowski, John Green, Chad Williamson. They've done a good job defensively.
Looks like Lehigh is going to go for it on 4th and 10. Nope, Kevin Higgins having second thoughts. Makes a lot of sense now to play field position at this stage of the ball game. Lafayette's defense guessed right again on that last play. 3rd and long, they chose to go man-to-man. When you're trying to throw a screen pass and you got a linebacker stuck right on the man, pretty impossible to do.
Lehigh is kicking it away now for the third time, but that 17 is a stark number for Lafayette. And it, again, underscores the troubles they have had with their kicking game, both in the punting department and the field goal kicking.
Lehigh doing something
well.
Interesting here, Rich. Going to punt the ball from about the 37-yard line. Actually elected to take a delay of game penalty to give them 5 more yards back to punch the ball. They're going to shoot for that pooch kick. They're going to try to drop this ball down inside the 20-yard line.
Freshman Jay Heibel has really been dependable this year. And the
that's out on the street. That's over in John's house.
It's on my porch. Call my kid.
he got all of that one.
You could see that, you know, what they had planned to do, but my goodness, what a great great kick.
Lafayette will have the ball early 3rd quarter, and they need to get something going.
My success as a small business owner didn't happen overnight. A lot of energy and a lot of persistence got me here. But it's time to take the next step. I need to grab people's attention and make a lasting impression. I need to be sure they'll know to call on me.
Get the Target Select advantage. We're today's business advantage. Tomorrow's business success.
Mountain Dew, a smooth, one-of-a-kind blend of citrus flavors. Mountain Dew quenches your thirst like no other. One taste and you'll agree, it's dew-rific.
Drink Mountain Dew and you'll discover what's inside quenches like no other. A blend of citrus just for you, so smooth it goes down easy too.
Neato!
That's a classic.
On the gridirons, the diamonds for working out or lounging around. Suit up with the best, Russell Athletic. Available at the newly expanded Bethlehem Sporting Goods. Bethlehem Sporting Goods, a Russell Athletic team specialist, carries a large selection of Russell Athletic uniforms, tees, shorts, and sweats. And Bethlehem Sporting Goods offers custom lettering, screening, and embroidering of group and team Russell Athletic wear. Stop in today for Russell Athletic wear and all your sporting needs at Bethlehem Sporting Goods, the team sport and trophy specialist.
For true comfort, it's the Comfort Suites Hotel in Bethlehem. Located in downtown Bethlehem, just a few blocks away from the beautiful Lehigh University campus, the Bethlehem Comfort Suites offers a variety of rooms and suites to suit your needs. Our friendly staff works hard to make your stay a pleasant one. Try our full-service restaurant, a great place to meet after the game, the Bethlehem Comfort Suites. When you're visiting Lehigh, stay with us. The Comfort Suites Hotel in Bethlehem is a proud sponsor of Lehigh football.
Lehigh University.
University has a new building that has been generating some excitement lately. The Zollner Arts Center, this world-class performing arts and education facility, offers a full season of music, theater, dance, and visual art. The current season includes such acclaimed performers as the London City Opera, Leon Bates, and Midori, culminating April 30th with an exclusive guest appearance of the Metropolitan Orchestra under the direction of James Levine. This gala concert to be followed by an elegant evening of dining and dancing. And for more information, call 6107-LU-ARTS. What a building that is. And great performances. And Tom Williams has had a pretty good performance, particularly in the first quarter, though we have not seen a whole lot of him since then.
And I think it's a product of this game turning just a little bit right now. Early on, we saw Lafayette's offensive line creating a surge and really controlling the line of scrimmage. I think the momentum has swung to Lehigh, and they're now dominating the line.
Palos on second down, fires or misfires. And the problem becomes, as the time ticks away and Lafayette finds itself in the 17-0 hole, that the Leopards have not demonstrated the big play capability through the course of the season. You can stick to your game plan for a little bit longer, but at some point, it's going to get a little more desperate.
And Kim and I were talking during the break. It's exactly right. I still think there's time for Lafayette to stay with the game plan, but at some point in time, they're going to have to put some points on the board. Last week against Colgate, they got into an early deficit, and it forced them to come out of their shell a little bit. Let's see if the same thing doesn't happen here.
Palos under some pressure, and that ball is batted down. It was a third down play. And Nick Martucci and Trey Slayton in there. Martucci has been so strong for this Lehigh defense. He's such a tremendous leader inside that locker room. Been some discussion about the covenant that the Lehigh players have entered into at the start of the season. We get another look.
This is from ground level, out of the shotgun. You see Palos, and Martucci's going to come in to his right. He gets that big paw up in his face and just bats the ball down. Bad punt again for the Leopards. Got a little bit of a roll out of it.
And the kicking game has just really hurt the Leopards all day long, especially in terms of field position. And when your offense is struggling, Kim, you need that punting game to be part of your offense.
It can be a weapon, absolutely. You know, still 9 minutes left in the third quarter here, guys. 17 points is not insurmountable.
Kind of hanging around.
Talked to Nick Martucci about that covenant. Maybe a little more has been made of it than really deserves to be, but the players got together in the offseason, the seniors, and decided, and we'll get to the rest of the story in just a moment. Stambaugh fires downfield, incomplete, broken up by Tuma. Second down coming up. And R.J. Ryan, the intended receiver. The seniors decided that they felt they needed to make a commitment, and one of the ways they thought they could do that was to sign a pact which said, we will not go to any parties and drink except for Saturday nights. And college environments being what they are, and I think lots of schools, particularly these two, have done a great job in curbing that. That's not an easy thing to do, but they all signed it, and they've entered into a pact, and it's been an amazing season. Stambaugh firing downfield, incomplete, just overthrown. Deron Braswell, the intended receiver. And Braswell's taken his share of spills this afternoon. He's banged up.
Well, Deron Braswell makes these kinds of catches. That time, Lehigh out of the shotgun went to five wide receivers. You're going to see Ron Jean line up on the outside. No backs in the backfield. You saw John Green bearing down on Stambaugh, but look at this. We've seen Deron Braswell make those kind of catches down the seam in the zone, just out of the reach.
Here's another great senior leader, Deron Braswell, one of the captains here. You see the numbers on Stambaugh. Solid. Third down. Stambaugh.
Oh, that's a great throw.
And it's caught by Deron Braswell and stripped and out of bounds.
This is a great throw by the quarterback, Phil Stambaugh. Lehigh had a flood left. They had three wide receivers to his left. You're going to see two go deep, one run the out ball. Watch Stambaugh on the run to his left, square the shoulders. Bingo, that's not a little 10-yard pop there. That's a 20-yard throw downfield, and he got the ball so early to the receiver, the receiver was able to turn and turn it upfield. Watch Stambaugh, watch the technique here. Ball comes up, boy, those shoulders came square to the line of scrimmage, and Braswell, like a loaf of bread, carrying that football there, Rich.
Stambaugh and gets rid of it. And
again, the poise of Stambaugh to throw that ball away. There's absolutely nothing there. On the previous play, too, Kim, I thought that Lehigh had the perfect call for the defense. I thought I saw the linebacker coming from that side, and boy, that allowed Stambaugh all kinds of time to let that play develop.
Lehigh has averaged 539 yards of total offense and punted the ball a total of five times in the last three ball games, excluding this matchup. So they have really been on a roll, and defensively they're playing equally as well. Ron Jean looking for some room, not much there, and John Green finishes the playoff, and the Lafayette defense against the run has been fairly solid today.
They have, Rich, and you know, they're getting into a pattern that has really hurt them all year long. They've been susceptible on third and even fourth and long. They really play well on first and second down, but it's been the third and long and fourth and long that they just have not been able to contain opposing offenses.
You're going to see it at ground level here, and Ron Jean, not a lot of running room, but in addition to that, Lehigh is guilty of holding, so a mistake by the engineers, or should I say the Mountain Hawk, is going to pull the ball back. You see the penalty indication there by the official. But you know, here again, it seems like Lafayette's bending, but not breaking, still hanging around. 9 minutes left in the third quarter, and Lehigh guilty of a mistake that's now going to put them at what, Rich? Second and about 16.
Phillipsburg, New Jersey.
Second and 24.
They got to go to the river to get this one, but you know what? Stambaugh's pulled it off before.
That's absolutely right. Four wide receivers.
A little toss to Ron Jean trying to get a little bit of it back, and they get about a handful back. Cologne drove him out of bounds. Third down coming up for Lehigh.
Angel Cologne that time filling nicely, you know, even with Lafayette back in sort of a prevent. There is another flag down on the field, guys, though. This one in the secondary. See what happens.
It's against Lehigh. Well, Kevin Higgins not happy with that. A little sloppy, and that's uncharacteristic. This team has done a good job.
You know, Kevin Higgins knows this is still a football game.
I was just going to say, Kim, it's a little too early to lose focus. I mean, it's 17 to nothing. This is a huge rivalry. What you don't want to do is allow Lafayette an opening.
Personal
because
foul, clipping
things could get interesting.
15 yards will be assessed from the end of the run, and we're still going to repeat. Second down.
Let's look at the right-hand side of the screen, see if we can pick up the call here. Number 10.
Nope, that wasn't the guy right there. Actually, this penalty occurred way downfield. Wasn't anywhere near the football.
Stambaugh to Braswell, and he is wrapped up.
And I think an acceptable play on the part of the Lafayette defense. There's a long way to go, and as you alluded to earlier, Kim, they don't want to give up the big play on a second, third, and just acres to go.
No, absolutely. Still about third and 22 now.
No percentages here in the blitz, right, Kim? I mean, they got to max coverage and force Lehigh to kick the ball.
Yeah, absolutely.
Stambaugh, third down, 23. Gunning it for the end zone, and it's a touchdown, Lehigh.
And how does that happen?
Cody Fedorcha.
Kim, is, you know, just a lack of concentration, a blown coverage on the outside. Phil Stambaugh is not a threat to run the ball out of that situation. I mean, you just can't let somebody get behind you on third and 22. And what a shame, possibly a backbreaker. There's no reason to come up for run support, but again, the cool, calm, collected Phil Stambaugh, been there before. Confidence does wonderful things sometimes, and I'll tell you what, that was a pop fly. I mean,
well, you know, Kevin Higgins had a gleam in his eye there talking to Phil Stambaugh on the sidelines, and that gleam is a product of a quarterback that's really come of age.
24 to nothing, Stambaugh to Fedorcha, Lehigh in firm control.
Yeah.
I think the real difference between Wendy's 99-cent super value menu and every place else is better tasting food. Since we make things fresh in our kitchen, they end up being more delicious. We bake our potatoes in an oven. Salads are made fresh all day, every day. Our chicken nuggets are all white meat. You get 5 for 99 cents. Our junior bacon cheeseburgers with 2 strips of bacon are made when you order them, so they're hotter and juicier.
Wendy's 99-cent super value menu. It's made for you.
Other places can copy the price, but they can't copy this.
There's a reason Overhead Door of Allentown is called the original. That's because we're the leader in the industry. Our superior construction, innovative technology, and professional sales and service set us apart. Our customers ask that they can have beauty and still have security. Once an Overhead Door, the answer is yes. Now that's original. The genuine, the original Overhead Door of Allentown. Look for us in the Yellow Pages under Doors.
Catch all the excitement, color, and fun with Pennsylvania's newest family attractions. At the Crayola Factory, the fun never ends. Right before your eyes, you'll see Crayola crayons and markers being made. And kids of all ages can play and experiment with dozens of exciting activities. And the Crayola store is a one-of-a-kind sensation, offering the most colorful and unique Crayola products and gifts. Both attractions are located on Center Square in Easton, just minutes from Route 22 and I-78.
Kim, you wondered, how did it happen? Well, here's how it happened. 6-play, 55-yard drive, 41-yard reception. Stambaugh to Fedorcha. Here's what went wrong for Lafayette.
Well, Lafayette's in the right defense. They're in a 2-deep, 5-under zone coverage. And number 18 here, Angel Cologne, has the second half of the football field, but he commits up and realizes his mistake, and you see him fall down.
Why would
right
he commit up, though? He's looking right at Fedorcha.
Right, you see him. He's getting a little bit of nose trouble is what that's called. He's coming up, but why? He's got a guy behind him trying to make a big play, probably trying to make something happen.
And you can't underestimate the arm strength of a Phil Stambaugh. That can't be the reason. I mean,
well,
you've got to...
You know, that's the thing.
Yeah.
You know, we've seen Stambaugh's arm in this game throw behind secondaries. And on that kind of a prevent defense, you can't take any chances.
Kim, how many times for the Lafayette defense are they going to have Lehigh backed up, second and forever, third and long, and they constantly give up the big play?
And, you know, it's also, put the shoe on the other foot, and it is characteristic of a great offense to be able to overcome those kinds of challenges.
Matt Andrade, who does the kicking. On kickoffs, and Lafayette taking it back, and here's a guy who just doesn't want to go down. That's Adriel Lanier, and he shirked off that one would-be tackler without even flinching.
Rich, early in the year, I passed Adriel Lanier in the Wawa over here, and I thought he was a power forward for the basketball team. This kid is a transfer from the Air Force Prep, and he is a specimen. This kid is a physical player. He's going to be around for a couple of years. Was hampered early by a broken ankle. If that's any indication of what he might develop into, good news for Lafayette.
Good size, 6'2", 200 pounds, and he's just a freshman out of Brooklyn, New York. Palos, and Palos needs to step up and play some good football at this point, because Lafayette is in a huge hole, down 24-0.
One interesting point, last week against Colgate, Lafayette found themselves in a similar situation. It almost forced them to come out of their shell offensively. Palos responded with his best passing performance of the year. It's a reach, Rich, but who knows?
They're averaging per game only 113 yards passing. That pales in comparison to what Kevin Higgins' team is able to put up. 295 yards a game through the air. And that probably will be an interference, and it is. Kevin Joseph is flagged.
Well, it was a smart play on the part of the receiver. I think, Kim, we'll let you handle it, but I'll tell you what, he seemed to have the defender screened off and forced the defender to come over his back. Can't do that.
Yeah, I think Lehigh defense is saying that this ball was actually
untouchable.
And because it was tip, they're going to pick up the
ball. Uncatchable.
Very good.
Third down.
Uncatchable. You're absolutely right, John.
Receivers coach Joe Tocario is just beside himself on the Lafayette sideline. Let's take a look.
That's a pretty good call right there, I'm afraid.
Ball was way behind the receiver.
Yeah.
That's a good play in basketball, Coach. You would know that. You know, it's a good box out right there.
Well,
yeah.
You know, and I tell you, I watched enough football to know that sometimes a receiver, the possession receiver especially, that's an art.
Third down eight from the 36. Palos with time, flutters it, and it's caught.
Yeah, this
and
is
that's first down.
This is probably the nicest execution Lafayette's had in a pure passing situation. Palos out of the shotgun, gets real nice protection. Look at the cup formed around him here. He gets just enough time to get rid of the ball. He anticipated where the receiver was going to be downfield. Nice execution that time in the passing game.
Yarbrough on the reception. First down 10 at the 49-yard line. Lafayette in maroon on their home turf, Fisher Field, but trailing 24-0.
Oh, look at that.
Leonard Moore, good piece of running.
Great stiff arm. Got to the landmark, which the offensive line coach tells you is the heels of that offensive line. And then at that point, it's up to the running back to pick and choose his spots. But you were impressed there, Kim, by the little stiff arm of Leonard Moore.
Leonard Moore showing why he gained 1,000 yards and why he's the second all-time leading rusher. Look at that. That's on a linebacker, by the way, guys. That's Brendan Moore, pretty good football player. And Leonard Moore showing just how strong he is.
Out-of-town scoreboard, and who knows, Lehigh may be running into either Massachusetts or Connecticut. And Barrett Hammond's on the reception in the first round of the 1AA playoffs. More on that a bit later on. Big game up at historic Harvard Stadium, where Lehigh rallied from a 17-0 hole to win earlier this year. Yale and Harvard.
Lafayette quietly putting together an interesting drive here.
Bucknell and Towson. Bucknell, fairly solid season for the Bison, looking to get over the 500 mark against Towson. And Colgate and Holy Cross tied at 7 in the second quarter. A bit of a surprise there. Leonard Moore yet again. Penn State at Wisconsin in a game with Rose Bowl implications. And here, Ohio State trying to shake the demons of
one
University of Michigan.
Eight. John Cooper against Michigan, 1-8. Pretty amazing.
Well, with all the success that he has had, some say his job may be on the line.
11-1 is not good enough,
but
right?
Today, well, they have to beat one team.
That's Michigan.
That's right. It's not unlike this ball game. Second down and 9. Halo stands tall in the pocket, but it's incomplete. Good coverage by Sondrell Davison. Sondrell has had a fine career. He's out of Atlanta, Georgia, your hometown, Kim. And Lehigh's done a nice job in the past several years recruiting ball players in the southern tier. They've got a number of players from Florida and Georgia. They've brought some talent into the program. And also interesting to note that this senior class represents the first full recruiting class for Kevin Higgins and his staff. And boy, did they judge correctly. Third down, 9, incomplete, intended for Barrett Hammond, overthrown. Not only did Higgins judge correctly in terms of the talent, but I think in terms of the character, clearly he has proven to be a shrewd judge.
Well, you know, I recall when Kevin took over as head coach, one of the criticisms or concerns was the toughness of Lehigh football teams back then. And I think you're right, Rich. Looking at this football team today, I think one of the characteristics of this team, offensively and defensively, is their toughness.
Well, Greg Clark, who was a great defensive player for the national championship team 1977, spoke to the 50 game club members yesterday at Lehigh, and we'll share that story with you in just a moment. Fourth down, and Lafayette forced to go for it. Halos throws, and it's complete. And Joe Luke has got his hands on the football.
This
and also had his hands on Kevin Joseph.
Catch.
That's a great play right there, and it's a big first down for Lafayette.
That's a great catch. You're going to see Ken Joseph, the defender, all over Luke, the wide receiver. Palos stepping up in the pocket. Look at that coverage. He's all over him. Couldn't have better coverage, and yet Luke still hangs on to the ball.
And Palos put the ball exactly the only place he could be. The only guy that's going to catch that ball is Joe Luke.
First down 10 at the 19. Williams. That 6'3", 240-pound frame, bowling straight ahead, and it'll bring up second down.
Big drive here for Lafayette. If they can push this one over, Rich, it could keep them in this ball game. And I'll tell you, it's kind of a microcosm of Lafayette's season. Things haven't gone their way. It's been a struggle all day long, but they just haven't gone away. It's a tribute to the coaching staff. They've kept these kids psychologically involved, and they don't quit.
Second down, six. Palos throws, and open is Joe Luke, who's having a fairly good ball game this afternoon.
Kim, I was impressed with your take on the Lehigh leadership. When a great situation for a coach is when your best players are your strongest personalities and your best leadership. That's very important.
Yeah, it's the only way you get to be 11-0. We see Palos here rolling to his left. Again, seems to throw better to his left than he does his right. That time the linebackers didn't get out in the flat, and that left the cornerback one-on-one. Good execution by Lafayette's offense that time. They got another first down now inside the 10-yard line, guys, and they've got something going here.
First and goal from the 9, trying to make this a football game. Leonard Moore barreling straight forward, brought down by Brian Wolovich. Second and goal coming up. On the subject of the toughness, Greg Clark, member of that 77 team, said that he was happy to see the style of football, the tough style of football, return to Lehigh. And when he made that remark, the entire room broke out into an ovation. And so I think it's something that the Lehigh faithful had been looking for some time. They've always been strong offensively, but they are back with an outstanding defense being tested right here. Leonard Moore slams into the line.
Well, of course, Greg Clark was on that 77 championship team, and they were led by a quarterback who I always claimed was really a linebacker, Mike Reeker, Catasauqua.
Now, Reeker to Steve Kreider, one of the all-time great combinations in Lehigh football history. Leonard Moore,
look at that,
solid numbers. Speaking of great football teams, the 88 Lafayette championship team back on campus last night, Frank Bauer and company, that was an outstanding ball club.
Saw a lot of those guys last night, and it was good to see them all.
Third goal from the 1, Leonard Moore, can't get it done. And there we see some of that toughness. Trace Slayton, who really clogs up the middle so well and has had good season.
Leonard Moore ran right into Brendan Moore, number 30 right there, the linebacker. Let's take another look at it. This is smash mouth football here, guys. Look at Leonard Moore. He's just lowering his shoulder. Good defensive football that time in the middle of the line, and now it's fourth down, Rich.
Well, Slayton got very low to start that playoff, and he bought some time for that speedy linebacking core. Moore, that's the other factor when you look at the Lehigh defense, is how well they run. This is as fast a Lehigh defense as they have had in a long, long time, and they're giving up only 11 points per ball game through the course of the Patriot League, but all 5 linebackers, they're interchangeable, can really run, and so can the guys up front.
Well, and I'll tell you, the 3 starting linebackers, that's Appling, Moore, and Eason, 2 sophomores and a junior, Rich, so, you know, a lot of strength coming back on defense next year for Lehigh.
And they've got some good young players, and one of the things that the Lafayette coaching staff, Rich, thought they could do is that they thought that they might be able to be physical against this Lehigh front, to counter the speed with the power, and it's very interesting right here that Lafayette is being challenged up the middle by this defensive front.
Let's go down to Eric March. Eric?
Guys, I just talked with one of the coaches on the sidelines. It looks like they're going to try and roll Mike Palos out, give him the option either to throw the ball or run it in himself, guys.
All right, Eric, thanks for that little tip.
It's interesting because the ball is on the left hash, so you'd think they'd go wide right. And so far, Palos has been more effective going to his left. Let's see how it turns out.
Plus, if there's a lot of ground over there, and we just got done talking about the Lehigh speed, so their ability to string things out might put the Leopards in jeopardy here if they go right.
We're late in the third quarter. Any hopes of a comeback fading and may be gone. How about that defense on fourth and goal?
Tough break for the Leopard offense. A real efficient drive all the way down the field, only to have the door slammed shut in their face at the goal line.
Were you surprised they went
to
32?
This is an individual effort. This is team effort. Look at this team. Look at the swarming white jerseys on that ball carrier.
It was David Pettit, 94, who got there first, but Ryan Mayo, the surprise ball carrier.
Well, Mayo's a tough runner, and, you know, he's a good second effort. He gets a lot of yardage after contact, but that time there were just too many white shirts.
Pettit got there first, then Appling, 35, finished him off. Ron Jean, first down carry. And psychologically, that's devastating for the Leopards.
It's just huge. You know, a score there, and I know that time is a factor, but you still got a couple of minutes in the third quarter, the entire fourth quarter. You never know if one score could really kind of uncork things. It wasn't meant to be.
Lafayette had its chances this afternoon, but we still have time left. Minute 30 in the third quarter. Brett Snyder, second down ball carrier. That Lehigh defense standing tall. Really, statistically, their best defense in nearly two decades.
And I think we need to start telling Eric Marsh to start talking to other coaches on the sidelines. We were looking for that option roll.
Yeah.
And they came with a full house backfield, two tight ends, and just ran, you know, off tackle, power against power there. And didn't look like they had a chance, really.
No, it really didn't. And you know, Kim, it's something that, again, the coaches alluded to. They felt that they could power the ball between the tackles. And I'll tell you, I'm not sure that they were expecting to face as physical a front as Lehigh is showing them today.
5-yard penalty. The down remains. Third down.
Everyone talked about the vaunted speed of this Lehigh defense. They showed some power on that stand.
Don't forget, they're missing one of their really outstanding young defenders in Reuben Smith, who was lost earlier in the year to a knee injury at Harvard, and he was in the midst of having a sensational season. So they haven't missed a beat. There's Pettit and Slayton. Those two guys we mentioned earlier, very unsung, but you're seeing today how physical they can play inside.
Now, third and long, deep in your own territory. I don't think Kevin Higgins wants to get too fancy with the football.
And after that penalty, Ryan Keene has
the ball
down, and maybe a lot more. Will anybody get him? There goes Gene. Gene is finally caught, or is he? No, he's in for a touchdown, Ron Gene. Wow.
And when you got a back like Ron Gene, Kim, you don't have to get too fancy. Great blocking up front.
And this baby is broken wide open, 30 to nothing. Jaron Tafe is now 44 of 44 on point after attempts on this season.
Well, we mentioned Kevin Higgins didn't want to get too fancy with the football, backed up in his own territory. I don't think he expected Ron Gene to take it 86 yards.
That there's... Watch the hole, Kim.
This is a one-back offense, man-to-man blocking, straight-ahead dive. And Ron Gene with the misdirection, the
great
cutback, right at the point of attack is what sprung him. And now he's just holding on, trying to keep those burners burning. Nice job of keeping the balance here. What an effort.
And it was that move at the line of scrimmage. Watch it closely. You called it, Jim.
Zone
right?
Blocking, man-to-man. They pick a guy in their zone and just go put a body on a body. But that cutback right there. And he's off to the races.
Well, what's interesting about Ron Gene is... against Columbia, he was called upon to be the feature back with Baker out with an injury for that game in New York City. And Columbia put eight men in the box that game, and Lehigh was held to negative yardage on the day. His next shot as a feature back without Baker in the lineup came against Bucknell, and Gene responded with a 193-yard day, and now 179, three touchdowns, and above Lehigh, you might want to soon add the letters MVP, because he's making a strong case for that late in the third quarter. Lanier is down at the 20-yard line, and it has been all Lehigh.
You know, I called it an 86-yard run. Forgive me, our statistician was wrong. He's fired. It was a 92-yard run, Rich, and you got to wonder, what's the longest run in the history of this great rivalry?
Well, I know that Craig Williams had one in 82, but the reason we thought it was 86 is because he made it down there so quickly. It was that extra 6 yards, but no one could run that quickly at 92 yards.
92 yards.
Malos under a little pressure.
Got the move.
Does well. We haven't seen it today. He can tuck it and run. And the big fella has more than enough for a first down. That run, by the way, of 96 yards ties the Patriot League record for longest run. It is the end of the third quarter, and it has been a dominant Lehigh effort. They lead it 31-0.
Tradition. Honor. A legacy. Reputation. A leader. To some, they are just words, but to Brown Dobb, they signify everything we are. Brown Dobb is a proud sponsor of the Lafayette Leopard Athletic Program.
Unless you win the lottery or inherit a small fortune, let's face it, you're working. But while you're out there jumping through hoops, Edwards Business Machines is jumping with you. One of the top 10 Konica dealerships in the country, Edwards gets you through the day with the right products and the best service. So next time you're thinking, take this job in, shove that thought aside and call Edwards. They work harder to make your job easier. Edwards Business Machines, your authorized Konica copy or fax dealer.
On the gridirons, the diamonds for working out or lounging around. Suit up with the best, Russell Athletic. Available at the newly expanded Bethlehem Sporting Goods. Bethlehem Sporting Goods, a Russell Athletic team specialist, carries a large selection of Russell Athletic uniforms, tees, shorts, and sweats. And Bethlehem Sporting Goods offers custom lettering, screening, and embroidering of group and team Russell Athletic wear. Stop in today for Russell Athletic wear and all your sporting needs at Bethlehem Sporting Goods, the team sport and trophy specialist.
It's the freshest face in Bethlehem, the Bethlehem Brew Works, located in the Bethlehem Commons. Featuring the finest in steaks, burgers, chicken, and fish. The Bethlehem Brew Works is dedicated to your satisfaction. A great place for family fun. Stop in after the Lehigh game and enjoy one of our many handcrafted microbrewed beers, aged to perfection, right on the premises. The next time you're looking for a new experience, try the Bethlehem Brew Works. The Bethlehem Brew Works, located at 569 Main Street in Bethlehem.
You're watching WFMZ, Channel 69.
Well, fans of Lafayette basketball are very excited with what happened this past week, John. A 63-46 over one of the most revered programs in the country, Princeton.
Well, what a great atmosphere that night. And I'll tell you, for a little while there, I had trouble figuring out which team was Princeton. There you see a little backdoor of their own. Look for good things from this Leopard basketball team this winter.
Well, they talk about Brian Ehlers, the 6'4 swing player from Long Island. John, you think your former basketball coach here, just get a look at him right there, number 32, could be one of the greats of all time.
I'm telling you, he's got size. He's got ball handling skills. He's too big for a guard to defend, and he's too quick for a big guy to defend.
Lots of excitement with Lafayette Athletics at Purdue tomorrow to face Gene Cady and company.
Top 10 team.
And then the Lafayette soccer program, the men's soccer team, facing tomorrow the number one team in the country, Clemson, in the Division I tournament, NCAA tournament. So good things happening. And Leonard Moore on the carry. Ron Jean sent a bolt of electricity through this crowd with that 96-yard scamper for a touchdown. It's 31-0. Rich Lerner alongside Kim McQuilkin. That picture tells you an awful lot about what's happened in this game and for the season for Lafayette. John Leone also with us. Pass complete to Barrett Hammonds. He's got a first down. John, the former Lafayette basketball coach, now in the development office at Lafayette. Still doing some great work with youth in the area here at Forks Township, and has been an integral part of the Lafayette scene for a long, long time. Eric Marsh is with us as well. Jeff Fisher, Eric Marsh, Lafayette's all-time greatest running back.
One of quite a few, Rich. I mean, the list of Lafayette running backs is long and impressive, and I've been around for quite a few of those guys. They've been fun to watch.
Kuyos, Shepko, and McIntyre, and
how about Tony Giglio?
Tony Giglio, and how about Ryan Priest, who went into the Hall of Fame last night?
Tommy Costello, Bruce McIntyre, Roger Shepko. I mean, on and on and on, and a big guy, Craig Williams, some years ago.
Well, Lehigh's had its share. We talk about Lehigh offenses. You focus so many times on the quarterbacks. You go back to 1971. Jack Rizzo turned in one
of the
great performances this series has ever seen. 313 yards on the ground, 31 carries, 4 touchdowns.
I had the pleasure of handing off for those 313 yards.
Nobody tackled him, he just got tired.
You know what a lot of people forget is that our tailback in that game, Don DiOrio, ran for 194 yards.
That's a lot of yards on the ground.
And then we picked up a couple of passing.
Kimley Quilkin, two-time MVP in this contest.
Going back up the hill and telling your roommate you got good news and bad news. The good news is I rushed for 194, and the bad news is
nobody
I was second
noticed.
Best. That's right.
Kim, what do you make of Kevin Higgins and the job that he's done?
Well, you know, what can you say about perfection, frankly? We see a holding call going against the Leopards.
Second down.
But I think the one thing that everybody likes, you know, the football people, what they really like about Kevin Higgins is his personality, is the fire, is the leadership qualities. There's a lot of different ways to tackle X's and O's, but when you're talking about leadership and you're talking about teaching and you're talking about molding young lives, as we see a real nice pass down the middle against a two-deep Lehigh zone, they're going to rule it incomplete, Rich, as
Barrett Hammond,
as I take over the
receiver.
Play-by-play no, here
feel,
for you.
Feel but, free.
you know, I think it's that's the thing that sticks out with Kevin Higgins is the leadership. Here we see it out of the shotgun. Palo stepping up.
And a pretty good throw, Kim.
Passing situation.
Might have been his best pure throw of the day.
Certainly in the top couple, yeah.
Tight spiral, the ball right where it needs to be. And again, one of those three components has got to, I mean, all three components have to come together. The protection, the reception.
Yeah, the rushing yards there is really jumping out at you. And, you know, there was 90-some yards in one run, but that's been the difference. Lafayette here, Rich, third and long.
All right, Palos, and he's got Tom Williams, but he'll be well short of the first down. Appling and Ian Eason are there to help make the tackle.
You know, Tom Williams showing us on that play what you alluded to earlier, John, how, like Brett Snyder, the Lehigh fullback, workhorse blocker, but has nice soft hands coming out of the backfield.
That was a hands catch reaching behind him, and you know, didn't have a chance to cradle that ball with his body at all. A hands catch, turned it upfield, but too little and probably too late.
Adam Holt, who has had a very tough day, will kick it away in this one. He finally gets a little air under, and Jason Pinckney fair catches the ball at the 15-yard line early fourth quarter. Lehigh leading Lafayette 31-0.
Hello, my name is Dr. Emil DiOrio. I'm an orthopedic surgeon and one of more than 75 medical providers at Coordinated Health Systems. Every day, we provide medical care to hundreds of people who have been hurt at work, home, or sport, and help them return to a healthy and active lifestyle.
Stop by or call one of our locations today. Coordinated Health Systems, the team that makes you feel better.
A watchful eye. Concern, offering the perfect solution, synchronizing the entire team. Your Dick Milham sales professional. Watching out for your interests. Offering the perfect solution. Concern for your satisfaction, synchronizing the entire team.
Join the winning team at Dick Milham Chrysler Plymouth.
Go Lehigh!
Dick Milham Chrysler Plymouth, proud sponsor of Lehigh football.
If the ocean were a couple of blocks from your house, you'd be there every day, right? Now imagine the next best thing, the Sure Thing, Marblehead Grill and Chowder House, where we bring the ocean's best right to your mouth. Live lobster and fresh seafood in a variety of tasty combinations. And for those who don't like to serve, there's great prime rib and steak. Either way, you'll be filled to the gills with great food. For something casual, coastal, cozy, and close, go with the Sure Thing. Marblehead Grill and Chowder House, William Penn Highway, a mile and a quarter west of Easton's 25th Street.
Lehigh football has a proud history and a winning tradition. A tradition that's built on ambitious goals, a sound game plan, and teamwork. At First Union, we use the same approach to enrich and simplify your life. we offer the widest variety of financial products and solutions. Services range from traditional checking and savings products to investments and trust planning. Call us and let us introduce you to our team, and together we'll build a winning tradition.
Not many smiles on the Lafayette sideline. Let's head down to the Lehigh sideline, Jeff Fisher.
Thanks a lot, Rich. One of the things I've been noticing throughout the game is the leadership on the sidelines. The biggest leader today has been Brian Baker, a guy that hasn't even been on the field. He spent most of his time with Ron Jean, the guy that has been backing him up all year, talking to Ron, pumping him up, talking to him about situations. That's why this team is going to finish the regular season 11-0. Back upstairs.
Thanks very much. Now the question becomes, will Baker return for the playoff game next week? And there's some speculation that he could very well do that.
It's an example of what we were talking about earlier, when your best players are your strongest personalities,
yeah,
and your good leaders.
Now, this is an architecture major, plans on going to graduate school, possibly at MIT or University of Virginia, one of the great student athletes. And Stambaugh is sacked. Now the Lafayette defense jumps in there. Garrett Neuenhuysen. Did I get that correct, Coach?
Garrett Neuenhauser.
Neuenhauser.
Yes, Neuenhauser, please. Neuenhauser is a presence on this campus. He really is. Actually, took part in the run for the charity Run for Cancer. He's a member of a number of student organizations, and Garrett does a nice job here. And finally, they get the standoff.
Bring up second down and 14. For Stambaugh and company, deep in their own territory from the 10-yard line. Stambaugh under some pressure again, gets away, looking for somebody, and incomplete.
Boy, I'll tell you, that's a nice throw by the quarterback there.
Brian Endler, the intended receiver.
On the run.
Stambaugh did about three things there I like. Stepped up in the pocket, moved to his left, bought himself some time, and then threw the receiver open down the sidelines. And I'll tell you, he continues to impress. Now, let's watch it here. He's going to set up right here, but he's got nothing. So he feels the pressure, and he just moves outside. Now he's instructing his people where to go. And on the dead run, moving to his left, he puts the ball right on the numbers on the sidelines. I'm looking like, I'm thinking NFL.
Let's talk about that in just a minute. Well, ball carrier for Lehigh on that play is Matt Goff, a fullback, backup. Well, let's talk about that. He's a junior. He's 6'4" tall, obviously has a strong arm, one more year to go. How realistic, and tell us exactly why you like him for the NFL.
Well, I like him for the reasons you just said. He's 6'4", he's 218, he's got a very strong arm, he's got a quick release, so he's got the physical tools. What he really needs to work on is technique, and he really needs to work on his drop back technique.
Able to kick it away, and he gets his first shank of the day. No matter how you slice it, a shank in golf or football is just not a good thing. More on Stambaugh.
Well, we're talking about working on his technique. He's got to work on his drops. In the NFL, the key to getting rid of the ball is your drops. And he's working a lot out of the shotgun right now, and he's also playing baseball, which means he doesn't get the work in the spring. Not that that's bad. The kid's a great baseball player as well. But I think if he's going to go to the next level, the last thing remaining for him is refining the technique of his position.
There's a backup quarterback for Lafayette.
What a great throw!
Ryan Bucic on his first throw of the game has Joe Luke for a touchdown, and now maybe you wonder. They wait too long to go to the backup.
Well, Brian Bucic did take over earlier in the season when the passing game was faltering. The things that he brings to the table, he's a classic drop-back passer. Throws a tight spiral, has a great arm. Not quite the physical player that Mike Palos is, but I'll tell you know, if Lafayette's looking for a spark, you look at the clock, is it too little, too late? But what a perfect throw right there, Kim.
Yeah, it was a beauty. We were just talking about quarterbacking and refining the technique of the position, and that was a great throw.
Bucic, a sophomore, 6'3", 200-pounder from Bloomingdale, New Jersey. Here's Menicola on for the point after, and it's 31-7, so the Leopards finally are on the board. We still have a lot of time to go. 11:05 to play. Lafayette gets it going.
tradition. Honor. A legacy. Reputation. A leader. To some, they are just words, but to Brown Dobb, they signify everything we are. Brown Dobb is a proud sponsor of the Lafayette Leopard Athletic Program.
There's no topping the red robin. Come on, along, let's all go bobbing to the red robin. Come on,
get up into the red robin.
You'll find something for everyone. Relax, unwind, we'll have some fun. Come on, let's go. There's no topping the red robin. Come on,
Tillman Square in Allentown and in Northampton Crossing at 33 North and Route 248.
The rest of a student's life is going to be spent involved with people. Learning how to work effectively with other people should begin right here.
There are a lot of things that I've learned that you can't learn in the classroom. Just relationships between people, how people interact, the way people treat one another. There's just no way. And even just the problems that certain people face that I've never been exposed to, I have been. And I think it definitely enables you to handle things much better as a person. It makes you a more well-rounded, better person.
Well, it's a cold day, but things are heated up for Lehigh University. They lead it 31-7. Lafayette finally getting on the scoreboard. It was Brian Bucic, the backup quarterback, his first throw of the day to Joe Luke.
They kind of caught us off guard. He's out of the shotgun as well. You see, he puts a lot of air under this ball, but he's thrown to the outside shoulder. Not bad coverage, actually, that time. But Bucic really put the ball on the numbers. Very impressive
throw. And that was a 34-yard touchdown reception. And barring a miracle, at least Joe Luke, the Phillipsburg product, who we understand may come back for another year of eligibility, will always have that memory of catching a touchdown pass in the Lehigh Lafayette game.
Definitely, he's a great kid. I deal a lot with Joe up on campus. He's a leader. For personal reasons, I'd like to see him come back. Joe knows what he's got to do, but he brings a lot to this program, and it would be nice to have his leadership back here next year.
Menicola to kick it away. And good kick, Brian Menicola. Lehigh will take over first down as Pinckney downs it. First and 10 from their own 20. Another great crowd for a Lehigh Lafayette football game, meeting 134, better than 13,000 on hand today. And it's chilly.
Rich, we've just seen two real effective kicks. We saw a Ryan Holt punt that had Lehigh pinned back significantly. That time, Brian Menicola sticks it in the end zone. It's just a shame that there's only 10 minutes left in this game because Lafayette seems to have gotten their kicking game together.
Stambaugh's numbers below what he has produced for the season, completing better than 67% of his passes on the year. That's a Lehigh all-time record. And Lehigh giving Ron Jean a little bit of a break, perhaps with an eye on next week. Kim, is that the right thing to do?
Well, you can't argue with that. Up 31-7, and it's not to say that he's completely out of this ball game yet. But
Phil Pleasant getting the work, number 33.
Unfortunately for Lafayette, I didn't see a lot of difference in the speed factor. Pleasant ran out of a couple of tackles right there, and really got to the outside in the face of some pretty good defensive pressure.
Misnamed him early on. Phil Pleasant, number 33, the running back. Spelling.
Kevin Higgins feels the Lehigh program has a lot of running backs in the pipeline. It's not a position they need to go out and recruit for the next couple of years.
Well, how about Jamal Bercher, the freshman last week, went for better than 100 yards late in that game. Lehigh ran for over 400 yards against the Bucknell defense that had come into the game sixth in the country, giving up 93 yards per game on the ground. So they can run it. Okay, out-of-town scores, UMass leading Connecticut in a game which could have some implications as to where Lehigh will go next week for the first round of the playoffs. Who knows, it may be down to Richmond or William and Mary.
John Fistner came up and put a hit on the receiver, and boy, just the sheer determination allowed that receiver to stay on his feet. Pretty good stick by John Fistner, nonetheless.
Bucknell all over Towson. That was Teron Person into the football game, number 37 for Lehigh. Colgate wrapping up a solid season, but it all came down for them to the game at Lehigh. And Lehigh, after suffering really a humiliating loss in Hamilton a year ago, paid Colgate back and then some with a physical pounding of the Red Raiders in a big game. Ohio State looks as though they are going to break the jinx, beating Michigan handily in the fourth quarter. All right, let's go down to the field. Jeff Fisher with a very special guest.
Thanks a lot, Rich. Who I have here right now is a guy experiencing his first Lehigh Lafayette game, Dr. Greg Farrington. And let's talk about the first game that you're seeing. What are some of your initial impressions?
Oh, it's been a fantastic day. It's a perfect football day. Well, almost perfect, a little cold. And it's been great fun to come over here and see the score go the right way.
What does the publicity of this season do for the university, aside from just the pure athletics part of it?
Oh, publicity like this is fantastic. Calls attention to all the great things Lehigh has and is, and most importantly, gives a real boost to spirit on campus.
How are you enjoying your first year with Lehigh?
My wife and I are having a ball. Awesome. We love an undefeated season.
All right. Got the playoffs next week. What do you think, a first-round win?
Sure. Of course.
All right, let's go back upstairs, guys.
All right, that is Jeff Fisher with the president of the university.
And you know, Rich, I think the Prez ought to take full credit for the undefeated season. He comes in his first year, they're undefeated. I mean, that's management.
Well, pass is complete to Joe Falzone. That was a third down play, and that'll be a first down for Lehigh. Kevin Higgins at the luncheon yesterday joked, after Dr. Farrington gave a very humorous speech, he said, Dr. Farrington's a very bright man, and everybody understands that. And he said, but long after he's forgotten about thermodynamics and all of those other things that he has in that brilliant head of his, he'll remember the Lehigh Lafayette football game. So a lot of good spirit in that room yesterday with all of the members of the 50 game club. And generates the same kind of enthusiasm over here in Easton as well, John.
A lot of good things going on this campus, Rich, and, you know, 134 games. There are ups and there are downs, but you see all of the neat things going on around us here on this campus, and the future bodes well for both of these places. You know, I just want to expand on something Kim was talking about and you were talking about before, Rich, about the stable of good running backs. And, you know, success breeds success. Kim and I were talking about this before the game. You come to a program that loves to throw the ball, you got a chance to attract a good quarterback. You put up big numbers, running backs want to come. So, again, it's no surprise that Lehigh's been able to sustain this kind of recruitment.
Where in years past it was heavily weighted in favor of the pass, as Person gets the call, Lehigh has become a very balanced football team. In fact, this year they've run the ball slightly more than they have thrown it, but very balanced throughout. And not just offensively, balanced as a team with a great kicking game and a very solid defense and great quarterback. Kim, how good is this football team? What's your overall take here, and maybe put it in some sort of a historical context?
You've seen I think it's hard to put in historical context without, you know, having seen those teams in the past play. But my goodness, you're looking at an 11-0 season here, and you've got to rank it up there as one of the all-time greatest teams in the history of the tradition and the history of Lehigh football. And the thing that jumps out at you is, you know, I hate to be redundant, but is what you've just mentioned, Rick, as we look at Ron Jean there.
With Brian Baker's coat,
so
number 26.
So he's either good friends or he's stolen Baker's coat. But, you know, it's the balance. It's every aspect of this football team. They're not dominated by defense or offense or even individuals. I mean, they've got a great quarterback. They've got some great running backs. Martucci, of course, on defense. But well-rounded, that's the thing.
That's Phil Pleasant. And earlier we saw Jamal Bercher. Bercher's number 23. Phil Pleasant is 33. They've got a whole stable.
Well, you're talking about leadership. You know, everybody that I talk to when you're talking about the offensive line says Jonathan Stigler. And he's the guy, maybe not the most gifted player, but one of those guys that's just a born leader. Even at practice, he's the guy that leads the tempo at practice. Coaches tell me when he misses a practice, the intensity isn't there.
You know, he was featured in our Domino's Pizza halftime report. Suffered a gunshot wound, a very traumatic experience, and has been able to battle back. And he is always pointed to, when you talk to the other Lehigh players, as one of the real leaders on this football team. and even has provided a source of humor. Kevin Higgins is generally a pretty serious-minded guy. Guy who holds a Bible study meetings early in the morning, has an open door policy for his players, very fiery and intense. But Stiegler came up with an injury, bent his finger back, and he said in front of the whole team, Coach Higgins did, John, don't worry about it, at least you didn't get shot. You know, I'm a little bit of morbid humor, but it broke up the whole team. And I guess Higgins and everybody, they've all really pushed the right buttons this year in terms of motivating this team. Pleasant on the carry.
It was Ryan Tuma made the initial hit and got some help as well from Andy Zabinski, and two of the stalwarts of this Lafayette defense all year long. You know, the defense has really been up against it this year. The offense has not been able to do things, and what a great stick. There you see Zabinski and Tuma.
You know, that is so characteristic of this game.
But, Kim, you're a quarterback.
Down 31-7.
You like hits like that?
Well, you got to remember, in the pros, I made a lot of tackles.
After interceptions.
Yeah, totally. So I'm used to being physical. But isn't that characteristic of this game, though? Down 31-7, and you still get those kind of licks that are being executed down there on the football field.
Great point.
There's John Stiegler. A big guy with a big heart and a real inspiration to this football team. And Stiegler, a senior, and what a gratifying feeling to finish your career having beaten your arch rival all four times.
I can tell you it's a wonderful feeling.
Oh, boy.
Sorry,
come on, guys. I'm out here now, fellas. And as good as it feels, can you imagine?
Every dog has his day, right?
It's been a series of ups and downs, 134 games, and I'll tell you, those kids wearing the maroon shirts right now, your heart's got to go out to them, not for lack of effort, not for lack of desire. And I have to tell you, you know, I've experienced some down seasons of my own and some up seasons, but you talk about what sports brings to your life, what sports can do for you, and how you handle adversity is just such a key element. And my hat goes off to how these coaches have had their team hang in there.
Fourth down one, Jamal Bercher spinning every which way.
I don't think he made it.
Did not get the first down.
Well, I think they're going to measure it.
Well, let's see. Depends where they spot it. You know, they may have it. Well, this is refreshing to see. This is a subject we would bring up in your era, Kim, back in the 1970s when you guys consistently contended for the Lambert Cup. Lehigh is currently running third with UMass and Connecticut playing today, and one of those teams losing. Lehigh may have a shot. Who knows?
Well, I think it's going to be really interesting to see Lehigh get into the playoffs and see how they do. You know, down around where I live, down in Atlanta, Georgia Southern dominates the 1AA scene down there in the South. And this year, I think one of the turning points in the season for Lehigh was when they defeated Wofford. Wofford being in the Southern Conference with Georgia Southern, and Lehigh handled them rather easily. And I think the coaching staff and the players felt after they defeated Wofford that they were really going places this year. So it'll be very interesting. Lehigh 10-0, not quite yet getting the respect in the national rankings that 10-0 might speak of.
16th in the latest national rankings. They won the Lambert Cup, by the way, back in 1957, 61-73. Kim McQuilkin, 75. Kim McQuilkin, 77. Mike Rieker in 1980.
With all due respect, I've got to give the 75 credit to Joe Sterrett.
I'm sorry, Joe Sterrett. That could be problematic.
Yeah, you're in big trouble.
Joe's the athletics director, and how quickly I forget. Joe Sterrett, one of the many great quarterbacks at Lehigh University.
Kim, I do agree with you. I think that next week, or I'm sorry, when Lehigh in fact does participate in this 1AA playoff, it's going to go a long way. I think it's a chance for them to get some national.
And, you know, it reflects positively on the whole conference, on
Definitely.
The Patriot League, on Lafayette. It affects Lafayette's ability to recruit next year.
No question about
that. If Lehigh fares well in the postseason.
It does. We saw the impact of the Lafayette basketball win this past week over Princeton. It kind of gets your attention. And I think that once all is said and done, after the intensity of this rivalry and the emotions of this game are passed, it's good for the Patriot League to see their representatives do well.
Well, we're talking about the NCAA playoffs. Find out who Lehigh will play with the NCAA Division I AA selection show tomorrow, Sunday at 1 o'clock on your source for sports in the Lehigh Valley, Channel 69 WFMZ TV. That's 1 o'clock tomorrow. We'll find out who Lehigh will play in. Big number 77, that could be a tough blow. The Lehigh offensive lineman, Steve Ludwig, who has had such a great game, and that would be a tough, tough blow late in this game to lose an offensive lineman, and hopefully it won't be too serious.
That's the last thing that Kevin Higgins wants to see right now, Kim.
And he's going, Jack Foley, the head trainer, is going right to the knee. You don't like to see that. Those trainers love to work on knees.
Well, Steve Ludwig does such a great job protecting quarterbacks and so forth. I slighted Joe Sterritt, and I don't want to slight some of the other great quarterbacks who won Lambert Cups at Lehigh, and I'll get to that in just a moment. This is Pleasant trying to get outside on a third down 11 play. Pleasant showing you some hard running. Well, the 1957 Lambert Cup team, quarterbacked by Dan Nolan, and Kim in 73.
Danny Nolan was 1950. And I can tell you that it was the last undefeated team in 1950. And Danny Check Nolan, that. By the way, so you know, is a priest in Savannah, right? Georgia, and is still a big Lehigh fan. I get to talk to Danny once every other year or so, and I know that he's at least listening in and should be remembered today because he's the last guy to quarterback a Lehigh undefeated season.
Now, Joe Sterritt in 75, and then Mike Reeker in 77 won the national championship against Jacksonville State. And John Whitehead was the coach. And get another look at a tough run.
Kim, right here, you can, you know, I just reminded of what you said a few minutes ago with score being what it is, what stage of the game. Watch the hitting that's going on down here.
Yeah, we got new Lehigh personnel in there.
It's Jamal Bercher.
A lot of new faces on offense, but you're right, a lot of sticks still going on with 3 minutes left in this football game.
First down, 10. New quarterback in for Lehigh. Lehigh has finally gone to the backup, Brant Hall. And that'll be it for Phil Stambaugh. Bercher on the carry. Check that person. I think a forgotten quarterback in the annals of Lehigh football is the 1980 quarterback, Larry Mikulski, who led the team to a 9-1-2 record. They made the playoffs that year, won the Lambert Cup, and then of late we had Scott Semptenfelder and then Bobby Aylesworth. And good legacy. Lafayette with Tommy Kirchhoff and Frank Bowers had their share as well.
Frank Novak.
That's right.
Great names in the annals of this rivalry.
Pleasant, great defensive play by John Green, who will leave without ever having beaten Lehigh, but not for lack of a great, great effort.
Great speed for a kid that size and great intensity.
Stample, who was an MVP in this game as a freshman a couple of years ago, puts up modest numbers, but certainly didn't do anything to hurt his team today and played a solid football game.
Well, and those are modest numbers by Phil Stample's standards. I mean, those are great numbers right there. And some really key executed plays, you know, third and long, that third and 20, and then the touchdown pass on about third and 24. I mean, he really came up with some big plays today.
Third down long as we head to the final minute of play, and Pleasant brought down. There's a fella who's played himself a pretty good football game, Chad Williamson. Well, we've talked about the leadership for Lehigh University there. Nick Martucci is maybe the supreme leader, heart and soul, the rock for this team. And, you know, we had a chance to talk with Nick, and he humorously recalled his first couple of days as a freshman member of this Lehigh football team.
It was rough. Yeah, I threw up, so I got my breakfast out early, and I don't know. I felt like I have a lot to prove to the coaches. Today was probably my worst day ever playing football.
It was my job to tackle the dive and the fullback. And the fullback comes down the line, I hit him, tackle him, and I'm underneath him, and I'm like, oh my God, like I made, on my first play, I made the tackle in my collegiate career. Like it was crazy, like I was so happy. And then all of a sudden I heard the cheers of the crowd, and I kind of like rolled over, and I saw like these feet running down the sideline, and this guy ran for like a 65-yard touchdown or something like that. And it was just, it went from like being at the ultimate high to being at the ultimate low. So it kind of started out rough, but I'm doing all right now. There's something with sports that just makes people like leaders emerge, and people take from that, and they're role models. And you know, coming to Lehigh, you don't really think that there you can fill that role because it's just like a smaller school and doesn't get a lot of publicity. But it just warms my heart when I see like a little kid come up to me and ask me for my autograph, and I mean, I'll take pictures with him, do whatever. And as for the team and being a leader, I can't help it. I'm very proud that I'm put in that position, and I hope I'm doing a good enough job.
He's doing a fantastic job. What a moment as he recalled that first, what he thought would be big tackle against Army, a game we did, Kim, and didn't turn out that way, but what a career it's turned out to be for a great young man. His pass deep down the field, Nick Martucci. We have 17 seconds to go. Nick Martucci hoping to go to law school perhaps, but may get a look by the NFL. He's got the size and certainly has a great spirit about him.
Well, he's got the quickness. I think he's going to have to add a few pounds, a la Richie Owens.
Yeah. Well, has the frame right now. They can put some weight on him, I think.
And is it the fact that the NFL has become so specialized might improve his chances? I mean, he's a pass rusher primarily, not as strong against the run, and not that he's bad against the run, but that might open up an opportunity for him.
Leonard Moore on what could be the final play of the game, and he is tackled, 11 seconds to go, and I think we'd be remiss if we did not hear in a game which this gentleman cherished so greatly, fondly remember, one of the Lehigh coaches who was lost to cancer earlier this year, Barry Fetterman. And here comes a little shower for Mr. Higgins. There it is, on a cold day, and he loves it. That's a great scene. And I know they all hold Barry Fetterman in their thoughts as this game plays out here. There was a guy who really loved football, was all about the Lehigh Valley and Lehigh University as well. And that's going to do it. Kevin Higgins' team completes a perfect regular season, 11-0, but they are not finished yet. Next week, they go to the 1AA playoffs, and that should be exciting. Bill Russo's team closes out a very tough campaign at 3-8, but they were up against a superior football team today, a team that is, as we said at the top, firing on all cylinders, Kim.
This team is running on high octane. They haven't let up, and in fact, they've closed with a rush.
Jeff Fisher is down with a winning head coach. Jeff.
Thanks a lot, Rich. I know all year long we took it one game at a time. It's now 11-0. You've got to talk and tell me what you feel about an 11-0 season.
Well, this is a special group of players. From the beginning, we started preseason camp, just the way they approached everything that they did. I don't know that we'd ever be amongst a group of guys like this that showed so much character and so much focus the entire time.
I was going to say, both sides of the ball, we've talked about it all year long, and again today, you got it from both sides. I know you had some plays you weren't happy with, but for the most part, a team effort.
Yeah, it was a great team effort. You know, Lafayette's got a lot of good skilled football players, and they gave us a great battle. But offense, defense, and special teams came up big for us.
Now you got one more big one in front of you, hopefully a lot of them. What are you thinking about the playoffs next week?
Well, we're excited to have the opportunity to represent our league in the playoffs. I think it's a tremendous honor for our players and the entire school, and we'll be excited to get after it. We want to win the football game now.
Congratulations.
All right.
Kevin
thanks,
Higgins leading
it.
Lehigh to its first ever 11-0 season. Let's go back upstairs.
All right, thanks very much. Lehigh Patriot League football champions. It is a feeling that they know well on the other side of the football. Not their year, it's Lehigh's time. And we'll be back with a whole lot more in just a moment.
The This is Jim Henderson and his buddy Mark Larson, the best of friends, inseparable since they were kids. Yeah. They do everything together. This year, they took up skiing and bought almost identical equipment. Mark got his equipment at a fancy ski shop. Jim, however, came to play it against sports, where he traded in some used sports equipment to get the lowest possible price on skis. It also meant Jim had money left over for lessons.
Play it against sports, next to Kmart on MacArthur Road in Whitehall.
Catch all the excitement, color, and fun with Pennsylvania's newest family attractions. At the Crayola Factory, the fun never ends. Right before your eyes, you'll see Crayola crayons and markers being made. And kids of all ages can play and experiment with dozens of exciting activities. And the Crayola store is a one-of-a-kind sensation, offering the most colorful and unique Crayola products and gifts. Both attractions are located on Center Square in Easton, just minutes from Route 22 and I-78.
Next time on Star Trek The Next Generation.
Ready for San Francisco, Mr. Whalen?
Captain Picard visits the holodeck for an adventure to the past.
Something's gone wrong.
Everyone inside could vanish.
A mysterious malfunction threatens their journey.
This is not a game.
Give me the gun.
Trapping them in a real-life murder mystery.
Shall I kill him?
No.
Kill the woman.
On Star Trek The Next Generation.
Tuesday night on WFMZ.
Lehigh, very thankful for all that it has accomplished this year. And it's a team of character, but the deep feelings and, I think, spirit as well.
Well, you know, special seasons happen once in a while. And for all the success that Lehigh has had recently, again, this season for them has got to be different. And on the other side of that coin, we talk about the adversity. We talk about emotional investment. And you know, Kim, you've been there, you've done it before. Win or lose, unless you invest yourself emotionally, you're not taking anything out of this sport, or any sport for that matter. So despite the fact that Lafayette comes up on the short end, the lessons learned right here, you just can't put a price tag on it. And these kids look back, yeah, it's a group of kids that have failed to beat Lehigh for 4 years, but you know what? Being part of the experience is worth all the effort.
Well, you have to remind yourself sometimes. We watch so many college football games or pro football games. Very difficult game. It's a brutally physical game, and these guys play for the sheer love of it, and they play it with an uncommon spirit and passion. And you have to tip your caps to both of these schools, because it's a difficult academic environment as well. These are two really hard schools, great schools, with the emphasis on academics. They don't play Thursday night football at these schools. They play Thursday night engineering and economics.
You've got that
at
right.
These schools. So, and you got to do it both ways here. The MVP of this game is not surprisingly Ron Jean. Guys, that the right call?
23 carries, 179 yards. Three touchdowns.
Tough to argue with.
He had that electrifying 96-yard run as well.
Kim, that looked familiar to you right there.
That is the MVP trophy.
Let's go down to Jeff Fisher. Jeff?
Thanks a lot, guys. Got a host of players here. Let's start with Nick Martucci first. Nick, you came here a long time ago. You've been through a lot. You get the outright championship and 11-0. Just tell me about the season. I know it was one game at a time, but now you can talk 11-0.
Yeah, now that it's over with, looking back, we can enjoy it for a little bit, for about a day now. But, yeah, it's really unbelievable. I can't put it into words. Just, it really hasn't hit me yet, but I don't know. When I get home and sit around and think about 11-0, it's really unbelievable, and I love all these guys. I'd do anything for them.
Thanks a lot. Good luck in the playoff game. Let's get Sam Brindley in here. Sam, I thought maybe one of the key points was when you stopped him at the goal line where you had to show some backbone. That's been the whole story this year.
Right. Our whole defense, we just stepped up all year. Coach Bott brought us along fine, and we built up a confidence through these games this year, and it's just incredible the way we've been able to hold people to, under 10 points a game. And we keep giving up these shutouts, though, which would be nice to get those. But
7 points isn't bad. You've played three big games in a row. Now you have a fourth one in the playoffs. What are you thinking at this point?
Right now, we got to find out who we play. We're not even sure who we play yet. So we'll go have that dinner tomorrow, find out who we play, and we'll deal with that tomorrow.
All right, congratulations, Sam Brindley. I got to look around here and see who else I have. I got Nick here, Deron Braswell. Come on in here. Deron, let's just talk about the win in the 11-0 season. How does this feel?
It feels real good. I mean, you can never imagine this, you know what I mean? You really set out each season trying to, go 11-0. This season, we wanted to take it one game at a time, but it really hasn't set in yet how good we played this season and the record. I mean, it'll all set in after the season done. We got a couple more weeks left, hopefully. But take that one game at a time also. But it hasn't set in yet, but I'm happy right now.
Congratulations. Let's go back upstairs.
Thank you, guys, and congratulations to Lehigh. Connie Hurlbut, the executive director of the Patriot League, now presenting the hardware. Yes, 11-0. Boy, that has to feel great. Yes. Back with some final thoughts in just a moment. Wish I could find mine.
After my accident, I was on several painkillers. I considered surgery, but I was scared. I didn't know where to turn. My friend told me about Ziegler Chiropractic. The doctors there are experts in whiplash and spinal trauma. They correct the cause of the pain and don't just treat the symptoms. They gave me just the right, gentle, effective care I needed. Now my pain is gone and I feel great. And best of all, they filed all my insurance paperwork. Now I know there are options thanks to Ziegler Chiropractic.
Ziegler Chiropractic, always on call, always there for you.
You don't have to be a great golfer to play at the Center Valley Club. You don't have to hit your long irons like the pros. Or chip like them. You don't have to putt like the tour players. You just have to want to. You just have to take the challenge. Take the challenge at the Center Valley Club.
Tradition. Honor. A legacy. Reputation. A leader. To some, they are just words, but to Brown Dobb, they signify everything we are. Brown Dobb is a proud sponsor of the Lafayette Leopard Athletic Program.
I've always had a dream. I'm living that dream on the football field. I've got big goals, and I won't let alcohol take them away. I have to work hard to get where I'm going. So many times I've been pressured to drink, but I've learned that the best answer is no. You can never win with alcohol. I've seen so many athletes make the wrong decision, the decision to use alcohol. I'm not going to let that happen to me. Just remember, if you want to go far, stay clean.
Lehigh completes the perfect regular season 31-7. They take care of business over Lafayette. They now know who Lehigh is across the country, I would think, and we'll find out next week as things will grow. You know, it's funny, Rennie Benn tells a story, the former wide receiving standout, of playing in a postseason game back in the 80s, one of the All-Star games, the Blue-Gray game. And he walks into the locker room, and there's Bo Jackson, and there's John Offerdahl, who played for the Dolphins. He couldn't find his locker. He finally finds his locker. He's from little old Lehigh. They spelled his name wrong, and it says Benny Wren. Lehigh, L-E-E-H-I-G-H. Guy looks at him and says, boy, you must be good. You came right out of high school to play in this game. Well, point is, they're gonna know who Lehigh is come next week. Second half highlights, Kim.
Bill Stambaugh. Stambaugh back in the pocket. This was out of the shotgun. You're gonna see him throw the ball downfield, almost intercepted. And one of the few mistakes Stambaugh made all afternoon, actually.
There's a kid who played a pretty good game on the other side, Tuma.
Yep. Brian Tuma has been so tough for us all year long. Done a great job for Lafayette.
But then this is the touchdown, I think, that really broke the backs. This was the third and 22. Somehow, Lehigh got behind the Lafayette secondary, playing a prevent secondary. And Stambaugh's arm took him all the way into the end zone.
Cody Fedorch on
Lehigh
the reception.
Lehigh came back from that. After the touchdown with the great goal line stand, you see the great team defense inside the 5-yard line. That was fourth and goal. And that led to Lehigh taking over possession and setting up the explosive run by Ron Jean. Just dive, eye back kind of dive, straight man-on-man blocking. You see the cutback in the hole, and he is off to the races.
Really impressed with the speed and the explosiveness of Ron Jean. And again, Kim, I alluded to the comments of the Lafayette coaches last night. Boy, going from the frying pan to the fire, you lose a Brian Baker. Boy, when you counter with a Ron Jean, whew,
you really, you know, you really need that kind of balance to go undefeated. And then this is kind of a pride play here. Lafayette coming back with its new quarterback. Bucic throws a beautiful, beautiful touchdown pass, getting behind the Lehigh secondary.
Kim, this season, this game was a microcosm of Lafayette's entire season. The few and far between opportunities that they had to take advantage of the Lehigh mistake, which were few and far between, they just couldn't capitalize.
And Glenn Hoffman needed to be pulled out of the way there.
It wouldn't be an undefeated season unless you had the obligatory Gatorade spill.
Sure, yeah. All right, Jeff Fisher has the game MVP.
Thanks a lot, Ronald Jean. MVP, how does that sound to you?
Feel real good. I didn't think I was going to get it coming to the game. I'm just was going to come in. Me and Baker, like, we always play timeout this on the day, but I'm just going to always come in and just do my job. And everybody else did their job, so that's why we come out victorious.
Tell me about your relationship with Brian. You spent a lot of time on the sideline with him. How did you use that to motivate yourself today?
We always, like, every game, we always talk to each other. Like, we always say to each other, like, it's our job to make the plays today. So he wasn't there. He told me before the game, he's like, just think of me out there whenever you're doing it. Just use it as a motivation. And I did.
And just describe the touchdown run. Did you know once you got through the first line, you were gone?
Nah, because I got caught last week, and they was making fun of me about that. So when I started going, like, I started running out of gas. It was like 20 left. And I know the guy was going to dive, but I was fortunate not to go down and keep going.
Congratulations, Ronald Jean, the MVP of the Lehigh Lafayette game. Let's go back upstairs.
All right, Jeff, thanks very much. Eric Marsh, thank you very much. Congratulations to Lehigh. John Leon, this was a real pleasure. Look forward to many, many more years in the booth. An awful lot of fun.
Because you know, you made it easy, and Kim, it was a pleasure meeting you, and Rich, as always, thanks so much.
John, great job, and Kim, partner, what's this? You're number 11.
We'll keep getting on,
huh? Thanks, partner. Great job.
Take care.
Well, what a season for Lehigh University, and they punctuate it with a win in the most important game. Were they 0-10 coming in or 10-0, it wouldn't matter. The fire would still burn as intensely as ever just because it is Lafayette, and there was no need as they charged onto the field of battle today. There was no need to fire them up any more than any other year because Lehigh Lafayette speaks for itself. Meeting 134, and Lehigh played, as they have played all year long, nearly flawless football. They started with a 31-6 win over Fordham, a home win. That was expected. And then they went on the road to an unknown quantity, St. Mary's of California, as we look a little bit more at the Fordham game. Stambaugh putting up some good numbers and a hint of what was to come. Joe Falzone on the receiving end right there. He had a very good opening first game with a couple of touchdown catches. St. Mary's was a bit of a struggle. Lehigh trailed. And if you had said at that point in the year that this was going to be an unbeaten team, you'd have said, you're crazy, because they just didn't look that strong in that game. But they managed to put the running game together in that contest, particularly in the second half, and that had Lehigh moving in the right direction. And there was the ball game against Princeton. Lehigh had a lead in this game. They let it get away. Cody Fedorcha, though, coming up with a big play, and this baby ended up going into overtime, and that is where Lehigh took control and won the football game over a pretty strong Ivy League team. Defense starting to deliver. Brendan Moore with a knockout blow right there. We began to sense that Lehigh would be more than just an offensive ball club. Then at Harvard, Lehigh down 17-0. And they made the big comeback at historic Harvard Stadium. Brett Snyder getting his hands on the football. And then the defense, Sam Brindley, coming through, and Lehigh was able to charge back and win that contest 21-17. They were then 4-0. And Kevin Higgins fired up. Then it was on to Columbia. Phil Stambaugh
against Towson State after the Columbia thriller, a 20-19 win, a 55-7 drubbing of Towson. That's where Lehigh began to find its offensive rhythm against Towson. Brian Baker, Lehigh spreading the wealth, so many different players getting their hands on the football. And then a 24-14 win against Holy Cross October 24th. In that game, Lehigh wasn't hitting on all cylinders, but they had enough to win the game with Ron Jean going in for the score. And at that point, they were rolling along. The pick by Sam Brindley, such a great player. 7-0 after the Holy Cross game, but then came sort of the second season. Things would get tougher there with games against Wofford, which comes out of that very strong Southern Conference, highly regarded, and Lehigh blanked them 28-0. And at that point, we knew this was a very special defensive unit. Wofford came in, and they were intent on jamming it down Lehigh's throat and doing what they wanted to do, but Lehigh had other ideas. And that game told us that this was perhaps a great football team, but three critical league games remain. Colgate, Bucknell, and then finally Lafayette. And it all ends today, the regular season, with a win over Lafayette. You know, Lehigh will wear this gem of a season for a lifetime. They'll always be able to say they played on a team which went 11-0. There'll be anniversaries and ceremonies to mark the occasion of the 1998 team which went 11-0. 25, 50 years from now, future Lehigh football players will be reminded that perfection is possible. Sons and daughters and wives will hear of the feat, and if the legend grows disproportionately, so be it. Legends are that way. And how very few of us are ever fortunate enough to have been part of something, anything, that was absolutely perfect week after week after week. Congratulations to Lehigh and to Lafayette for putting up a great fight, and to the fans of both sides, another treat, another memorable third Saturday in November. May there be 100 more. Lehigh wins it 31-7 over Lafayette. For the entire crew, so long from Fisher Field.
You can find all the best books at the Lehigh University.